Hello friends, I'm Dr. Ankit. Now today we will be starting with diuretics. Okay, so now what do we mean by the word diuretic? Diuretics are those drugs which increases urinary volume. Okay, which increases urinary volume. Urinary volume is also known as urinary flow rate. Okay, so diuretics are the drugs which increases urinary volume or urinary flow rate. Now these diuretics, they are divided into two types. Either they will predominantly remove sodium in the urine, or they will predominantly remove water in the urine. Okay, now the drugs which predominantly remove sodium in the urine, they are known as natriuretics. These diuretics are known as natriuretics, and the drugs which predominantly removes water in the urine, they are known as aquarectics. Okay, they are known as aquarectics. So diuretics, they will increase urinary volume either due to removal of sodium or due to removal of water. But we commonly call natriuretic drug as a diuretic. Okay, we commonly call natriuretic drug only as the diuretic. Okay, so it's a common scenario. Now let's see first about how does a normal kidney functions. Okay, so first we should learn about physiology. So let's see, suppose this is a nephron and this is a glomerulus. Here the blood is coming to the kidney, the blood is coming to the kidney, and this is glomerulus. We know that sodium and water which is present in the glomerulus is freely filtered. It is freely filtered into the kidney. This first part of the kidney is known as Bowman's capsule. Suppose there were 100 molecules of the sodium which got filtered. Okay, 100 molecules of the sodium which got filtered. Now what happens when this sodium gets filtered into the kidney? 60% of this sodium, you will write, 60 to 65% of this sodium is reabsorbed back into the blood. This sodium, 60 to 65% of this sodium gets reabsorbed back into the blood. This portion of the kidney where it is getting reabsorbed, this first portion is known as PCT. This first portion is known as PCT. PCT stands for proximal convoluted tubule. Okay, this portion is known as PCT. Here 60 to 65% of the sodium gets reabsorbed. Now how it gets reabsorbed, you will write that here sodium gets reabsorbed back into the blood with the help of one enzyme. That enzyme reabsorbs sodium as well as bicarbonate. Okay, how much sodium? 60 to 65%, around 2/3. Now which enzyme is responsible for reabsorption of sodium back into the blood? You will write carbonic anhydrase. Okay, so you write here carbonic anhydrase enzyme is responsible for reabsorption of sodium back into the blood at the area of PCT. Now what happens, this remaining sodium now goes down. This part of the kidney is known as descending limb of Henle. Okay, now this above portion of the kidney is cortex and the deeper portion is known as medulla. It is going more deeper. Now remember, this part of this limb of Henle, descending limb of Henle, it is only permeable to water. It is only permeable to water. It is not permeable to sodium. Here sodium is not reabsorbed. Now when this limb of Henle ascends upward, this is known as ascending limb of Henle. This is known as ascending limb of Henle. Now can we say that this portion was descending limb of Henle, and in descending limb of Henle the water is, only water is getting reabsorbed. Okay, now when this nephron ascends upward, this nephron becomes thick, it becomes thicker. This portion is known as thick ascending limb. This portion of kidney is known as, nephron is known as thick ascending limb. Okay, Let's call it as TALTAL. TALTAL stands for thick ascending limb. Now, can we say that this thick ascending limb has two portions, one medullary portion and one cortical portion? Here, in thick ascending limb, sodium can be reabsorbed back into the blood. Here, in medullary portion, we have one transporter. That transporter reabsorbs sodium back into the blood. That transporter name is sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter. So the transporter name is sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter that reabsorbs sodium potassium and 2 chloride ions back into the blood. And you will write here 25% of the sodium gets reabsorbed. 25%. Okay. So in this medullary portion, there is a transporter known as thick. In the thick ascending limb of medullary portion, sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter, it reabsorbs. Now, when this thick ascending limb of Henle ascends upward, suppose this is the cortical portion. Can we say it is the cortical portion? In this cortical portion, and this part is known as DCT. DCT stand for distal convoluted tubule. Let's divide the DCT into two parts. One early part and one late part. Okay. In this cortical portion of thick ascending limb and early part of DCT, there is one transporter known as sodium chloride symporter. Sodium chloride symporter. Here sodium gets reabsorbed back into the blood with the help of a transporter, sodium chloride symporter. And remember, here only 10% of the sodium gets reabsorbed. Only 10% of the sodium gets reabsorbed. Now the remaining portion is, if we see, we have a remaining portion of late DCT, and this portion is known as collecting duct. This portion is known as collecting duct. So in late portion of DCT and the cortical portion of collecting duct, so only sodium gets reabsorbed back into the blood. Only sodium gets reabsorbed back into the blood with the help of one hormone known as aldosterone. With the help of one hormone, aldosterone. When sodium gets reabsorbed back into the blood, instead of sodium, other ions, they will sacrifice. Who will sacrifice? You will write potassium, hydrogen, and other ions, they sacrifice. Okay. So here in cortical portion of collecting duct, sodium gets reabsorbed with the help of one hormone, aldosterone, and you will write only 2% of the sodium gets reabsorbed here only. Okay. Now what about the medullary portion? You will write that this medullary portion, again, the water is only reabsorbed. Here, only water is reabsorbed. Okay. Now, here water is reabsorbed with the help of one hormone known as ADH hormone. Okay. ADH, or you will write another name of ADH hormone is vasopressin. Vasopressin. Okay. So this is how normally kidney functions. So I'll just repeat again. Okay. I'll just repeat again this for you so that you will have a good idea. Okay. So we have discussed that sodium is getting reabsorbed at three locations. The first one is PCT. The first site where sodium is getting reabsorbed is proximal convoluted tubule with the help of one hormone, carbonic anhydrase, and around 60 to 65% of sodium gets reabsorbed. Second part is medullary portion of thick ascending limb. That is the second portion. Here, sodium is getting reabsorbed with the help of a transporter, sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter, and around 25% of the sodium gets reabsorbed. Now, the third portion is cortical portion of thick ascending limb and early part of DCT. Here, sodium gets reabsorbed with the help of a transporter, sodium chloride symporter, and around 10% of the sodium gets reabsorbed, and the remaining portion of the sodium gets reabsorbed in the collecting duct and late part of DCT with the help of hormone aldosterone. And in the medullary portion of collecting duct, only water is reabsorbed with the help of hormone ADH. Okay. Now, let's discuss first about the drugs natriuretics, okay, or diuretics. Let's talk about first natriuretics, which are also known as diuretics. Okay. Now, natriuretics, they will promote sodium excretion in urine. Now, sir, how they will promote sodium excretion in urine? Remember, they inhibit reabsorption of sodium. They inhibit reabsorption of sodium in nephron. Okay? They inhibit reabsorption of sodium in nephron. Now we know that sodium was getting reabsorbed at four sites. The first part was PCT. Here the sodium was getting reabsorbed with the help of an hormone, carbonic anhydrase. So the first diuretic we have is a diuretic which will inhibit this hormone, which will inhibit reabsorption of sodium and bicarbonate into the blood. Hence this sodium will remove out into the urine. So the first diuretic we have, you will write is carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Okay, the first class of diuretic we have is carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. Where they will be acting, you will write, they will act at PCT of kidney. They will act at proximal convoluted tubule of kidney. Okay, now the second class of diuretic we have, which will inhibit this second part, sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter in cortical portion of thick ascending limb. These diuretics are known as loop diuretics. These diuretics are known as loop diuretics. Where they will act, you will write, loop diuretics, they will act at thick ascending limb. Thick ascending limb. In which portion of the kidney? Nephron. In medullary portion. Okay, so can you tell me which transporter they will be inhibiting? And when they will act here, you will write, they inhibit sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter. So this is loop diuretics. Okay, now the third diuretic we have is thiazides. These thiazide diuretic, they will act at this cortical portion of thick ascending limb and early part of DCT, and they will inhibit this sodium chloride symporter. So you will write, where they will be acting? Thiazide diuretic, they will act at cortical part of thick ascending limb. Let's write the short form as TAL, thick ascending limb, plus early part of distal convoluted tubule. Early part of distal convoluted tubule. This portion together is known as distal tubule. Okay, and when these thiazides, they will act on this distal tubule, they will inhibit sodium chloride symporter. They will inhibit sodium chloride symporter. Okay, now the last diuretic, the second last diuretic we have is potassium sparing diuretics. The second last we have is potassium sparing diuretic. Potassium sparing diuretic, what they are? So these drugs, they will inhibit the action of aldosterone. If aldosterone will not able to act, can we say this sodium will move out into the urine? And if sodium will move out into the urine, the potassium will not come out into the urine. The potassium will be spared. Okay? So hence they are known as potassium sparing diuretic. They will act at late part of DCT plus collecting duct. They will act at late part of DCT and collecting duct. And what is their mechanism of action? They will inhibit aldosterone action. They will inhibit aldosterone. Okay? And the first one, they are acting on PCT. They are inhibiting carbonic anhydrase enzyme, as their name is. They will inhibit carbonic anhydrase enzyme. Okay, the first one. Enzyme. Okay. Now, apart from this, we have one more diuretic, that is osmotic diuretic. Sir, osmotic diuretic, they generally act at PCT plus descending limb of Henle. Plus medullary portion of ascending limb of Henle. That means, which is this portion? Let's talk about this portion as, I'll draw this portion in white. So it will act on PCT. It will act on this DCT, distal descending limb, and this medullary portion till this. Okay. So these are the area where osmotic diuretic will act. Okay, and they will exert osmotic pressure. They will exert osmotic pressure. Now, when they will exert osmotic pressure, the water will not get reabsorbed. Okay, that we will discuss in great detail. So these are the class of diuretics we have. Okay, these are the classes of diuretic we have. So let's start with the first one, that is carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Okay, let's start with the first one, that is carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. So let's make a heading. Okay, now remember, carbonic anhydrase enzyme, it was present on where there was acting, they are acting on PCT of kidney. PCT stand for proximal convoluted tubule. Okay, and on proximal convoluted tubule, they inhibit carbonic anhydrase enzyme. Okay, they inhibit carbonic anhydrase enzyme. And this carbonic anhydrase enzyme was responsible for reabsorption of mainly bicarbonate into the blood. Okay. Now this, when bicarbonate used to get reabsorbed back into the blood, with this bicarbonate, sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium, all other positively charged ions to maintain the charge also get reabsorbed. So if this carbonic anhydrase enzyme is responsible for reabsorption of these ions back into the blood, and we have inhibited this enzyme, can we say all these ions will be lost out in urine? They will be lost in urine. Okay, they will be lost in urine. So let's see what are the drugs we have. Okay. So among carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, we have two kinds of drug. These drugs, either they are given systemically. Systemically means either orally or IV. Or they can be given as a topical eye drops. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have. Among systemically, you will write a very important drug, acetazolamide. Okay, other drugs you will write, diclorphenamide and methazolamide. methoxsalamide. Among topical eye drop, you will write dorzolamide and brinzolamide. Now, as you are seeing that all these drugs, they are ending with the word amide, hai na? They all are ending with the word amide. Now, why they are ending with the word amide? Because all these drugs which we have written, all these drugs are chemically sulfonamides. All these drugs are chemical in their chemical nature, they are sulfonamides. And remember, any drug which contains sulfa, that means sulfonamide, causes allergic reactions. That we will discuss later on. So all these drugs are sulfonamide. What is their chemical nature? They are sulfonamide derivative. That is why they all are ending with the word amide. Okay? All they are ending with the word amide. Now second point, sir, how do these drugs, they inhibit carbonic anhydrase enzyme? In which pattern they will inhibit? You will write, sir, all these drugs, they are non-competitive plus reversible inhibitor of this enzyme carbonic anhydrase. Okay, so all these drugs are non-competitive reversible inhibitor of carbonic anhydrase enzyme. See, it's very important because most of the non-competitive inhibitors, they are irreversible inhibitor. Very few non-competitive inhibitors we have which are reversible inhibitor. Okay, so most of the non-competitive inhibitors are what we are having are non-competitive, but they are reversible. So it becomes very peculiar and becomes a very important question. Okay, now let's see where these drugs are used. What are the uses? For uses, you just write one mnemonic, game plan. The mnemonic is G, A, M, E, and P. Okay, so it has mainly 5 uses. Okay, the first use of these drugs is, you will write, the first use is G for glaucoma. They are used in glaucoma. Okay, now in which glaucoma? You will write, in one emergency narrow angle glaucoma or intraoperative glaucoma. It's an emergency. In these two conditions, we give intravenous acetazolamide. Okay, and there is one very subtle disease which is not an emergency, open angle glaucoma. In open angle glaucoma, we give topical eye drops of dorzolamide and brinzolamide because it is not an emergency. Narrow angle glaucoma is a very dangerous condition. So you will give dorzolamide and brinzolamide. Okay. Now, what is their mechanism of action in glaucoma? Remember, this carbonic anhydrase enzyme is also present in our ciliary epithelium. When we inhibit this carbonic anhydrase enzyme, it decreases the secretion of aqueous humor. It decreases the secretion of aqueous humor into the eye. Because of this reason, they will suppress intraocular pressure and the glaucoma will be ready. What side effect do they produce in eye when they are used in glaucoma? Remember, these are the only anti-glaucoma drug we have which itself causes secondary glaucoma. They cause secondary glaucoma. Why they cause secondary glaucoma? Because of ciliary edema. Because of ciliary edema. Second point, they cause pseudomyopia. They cause pseudomyopia. Why? Because of corneal and lens edema. Okay, so these part we have already discussed in great detail. Just refer to the videos of glaucoma, that why they are causing edema in the eye, why these drugs they cause edema in the eye, we have already discussed, okay, in the glaucoma videos. So this is their side effect. So they are used in the treatment of glaucoma, but themselves they cause glaucoma. Okay, they themselves causes glaucoma. Now let's see the second use of these drug. The second use of these drug, you will write A for, you will write they are used for alkalinization of urine. They are used for alkalinization of urine. Now, what do we mean by alkalinization of urine? It means they will turn the pH of urine alkaline. Now, why they are turning the pH of urine alkaline? Let's see back. As we know, they are causing loss of bicarbonate in the urine. This bicarbonate loss in the urine turns the pH of urine alkaline. Okay? It turns the pH of urine alkaline. Why? Because acetazolamide like drug, they cause bicarbonate loss in urine. Hence, they turn the pH of urine alkaline. Now, as they are used in alkalinization of urine, they are causing alkalinization. Where they are used? They are used for weak acidic drug poisoning. They are used for weak acidic drug poisoning. Remember, in acidic drug poisoning, we turn the pH of urine alkaline. Okay? So they will become more water soluble and it will be excreted out in urine. And they are used for the treatment of acidic stones. Those stones which are formed in acidic urine. The example of such stone is, you will write as cystine stone. Cystine stones. So cystine stones, remember, they are formed in acidic urine. So they are used for the treatment of cystine stone. You can write 2 point. Cystine stones, they are the hardest stone of the kidney overall. And the shape of this structure is just like this ring. The shape is hexagonal. The shape of cystine crystals are hexagonal. Okay. So they are used in the treatment of acidic drug poisoning and acidic stones because they turn the pH of urine alkaline. But what is their side effect? Side effect of acetazolamide like drug is it itself causes renal stones. It itself causes renal stones which are formed in alkaline urine. Which are formed in alkaline urine. The classical example of a stone which is formed in alkaline urine is, you will write, calcium oxalate stone. Calcium oxalate stone. And the shape of the calcium oxalate stone is just like this. It's an enveloped shape. Okay, the shape is enveloped shape. So remember, this carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, they are used for the treatment of acidic stone, but they themselves causes certain acidic stone. So they were used in the treatment of glaucoma, they themselves were causing glaucoma. They are used in the treatment of acidic stone, but they themselves causes renal stone. Okay, but I will tell you shortly, there is one diuretic which is used for the treatment of calcium stone. There is one diuretic which can be given for the treatment of calcium stone, that will be, which we will discuss shortly, will be thiazides. Okay, we will discuss that thiazide is used for the treatment of calcium stone because they will preserve calcium. Okay, now let's move further. The third use of these drugs, you will write, the third use of these drug is, sir, can we say that these drugs are causing bicarbonate loss in urine? Okay, from the blood, can we say bicarbonate is lost in the urine? So what will happen in the blood? Can we say if urine is becoming alkaline, the blood will become, the blood is formed, the urine is formed from filtration of the blood. So the blood, it will become, in the blood there will be acidosis. So if in the blood there will be acidosis, it is known as metabolic acidosis. So these drugs, they produce metabolic acidosis in blood. Why? Because they increase H plus level in blood. They increase H plus level in the blood. Because in our blood there is a balance between H plus ion and bicarbonate ion. Okay, if the urine will become alkaline, the blood will become acidic. So they cause slight metabolic acidosis in the blood. Now what is the importance? can we say there will be increase in H plus ions in the blood? Okay, and remember these H plus ion or acidosis condition, it stimulate our respiratory centers. It stimulates our respiratory centers. Because of this reason, acetazolamide is a drug of choice for acute mountain sickness. Acute mountain sickness. Why? Because, sir, in acute mountain sickness, the patient suffers from respiratory depression. Why respiratory depression? Because of metabolic alkalosis. That means in the blood there is increase in bicarbonate ion. Because of this reason, person does not breathe. So acetazolamide is a drug of choice for acute mountain sickness. Why it is the drug of choice for acute mountain sickness? Because it increases H plus ions, which stimulate our respiratory centers. Okay, so remember this part. But you will write, these acetazolamide lug, they are absolutely contraindicated if already there is very high chance of metabolic acidosis. They are absolutely contraindicated in COPD. COPD stands for chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Why? Because in COPD already the patient suffers from hypoxia, and from hypoxia there is already metabolic acidosis. The patient already suffers from metabolic acidosis. So because of the dangerous level of metabolic acidosis, acetazolamide like drug, they are absolutely contraindicated in COPD. Okay, they are absolutely contraindicated in COPD because this metabolic acidosis may become dangerous and the patient may die. Okay, so remember this part. Now the fourth use of this drug you will write will be E4. They are used in the treatment of epilepsy. They are used in the treatment of epilepsy. Which epilepsy? You will write, they are used in the treatment of catamenial epilepsy. Okay. And they are sometimes given in cases of absent seizures. They are sometimes given in cases of absent seizures. But you will write, they are not the drug of choice. They are not the drug of choice. Now why they are given in epilepsy? Because, sir, they directly suppress neurons. They directly suppress the neurons in our brain. Because of this reason, in epilepsy and seizures, the neurons are firing abnormally. Okay, so these drugs, by inhibiting carbonic anhydrase enzyme, they can directly suppress neurons. Okay, but what is their side effect? Sir, can we say that peripheral neurons will also get suppressed? So they will cause altered sensation or paresthesias. Paresthesia. And they also cause drowsiness because of suppression of neurons. They also cause drowsiness. Okay. And the last use of these drugs you will write is they are used in periodic paralysis. Periodic paralysis means muscle weakness. Okay, paralysis means muscle weakness. Why it occurs? It occurs due to hyperkalemia. It occurs due to hyperkalemia. Now why acetazolamide like drug are used in hyperkalemic periodic paralysis? Because they themselves causes hypokalemia. Because of this reason, they will improve this symptom. Okay, so one drug is an approved among all, only one drug is approved for periodic paralysis. You will write, only dichlorphenamide is approved. Dichlorphenamide is an approved drug for periodic paralysis. Okay, so this dichlorphenamide is an approved drug for periodic paralysis. Okay, so These are the uses. Let's recapitulate what are the uses. So we discussed that acetazolamide drug, they have mainly five uses: game plan, G for glaucoma. Okay, so in narrow angle glaucoma and intraoperative, we give intravenous acetazolamide. In open angle glaucoma, we give topical dry eye drops of dorzolamide and brinzolamide. What is their mechanism of action in glaucoma? They decrease secretion. But when they are used in glaucoma, they themselves causes glaucoma and they increase the thickness of lens and cornea, which leads to pseudomyopia. Okay, so they cause edema. Now, they are also used for alkalinization of urine. Why? Because they cause bicarbonate excretion out in urine. So if bicarbonate is lost in urine, it is used in the treatment of acidic drug poisoning and acidic stones. Okay, and which acidic stone? You write cystine stone. They are the hardest and hexagonal stones. And then we have renal stones. Their side effect, they themselves cause renal stone. Now which stone? Alkaline stone, which are calcium oxalate stone, enveloped shape. So calcium oxalate stone, we can use thiazides for their treatment. And they also cause metabolic acidosis, hence they are used in mountain sickness. But they are contraindicated in COPD. They are used in epilepsy. Not the drug of choice anywhere, but they can be used in catamenial and absent seizure. Their side effect will be paresthesia and drowsiness. And last uses, periodic paralysis. Diclofenamide is an approved drug. Now let's see what is their side effects. So let's see, various side effects we have already discussed. Let's talk about other side effects. Their first side effect is, sir, they cause ammonia retention or ammonia reabsorption. Ammonia reabsorption. Okay. Now, suppose, sir, this is the PCT cell of the kidney. Okay, PCT. And this is the blood. Suppose there is one molecule in the PCT, that is ammonia. Structure of ammonia is NH3. Okay. Now remember, this ammonia can become water soluble. The water soluble form of ammonia is ammonium. And remember, only this ammonium is water soluble. It is removed out in urine. Why? Because it is water soluble. Okay. Can we say that to convert this ammonia into ammonium, what we need? We need H plus. We need H plus in the urine. That means ammonium get excreted in urine only when the urine is acidic. It only gets excreted in acidic urine because it need H plus, so that this ammonia could be converted into ammonium. But the point is, we know that acetazolamide drug, there is no H plus, there is rather bicarbonate. Bicarbonate means they do not turn the pH of urine acidic, they rather turn the pH of urine alkaline. This ammonia cannot be converted into ammonium. So what will happen? So this ammonia is lipid soluble. This ammonia is lipid soluble. This ammonia will be reabsorbed back into the blood. This ammonia will be reabsorbed back into the blood. So normally there is no problem if this ammonia gets reabsorbed back into the blood, because this ammonia, normally it goes to the liver, and this ammonia, it renders non-toxic. It will become non-toxic in the liver. How it will become non-toxic? It will be converted into urea. Okay, so normally if this ammonia is getting reabsorbed back into the blood, then it is not a problem. Why? Because it is getting non-toxic. But the problem occurs if the patient is suffering from liver failure. If the patient is suffering from liver failure, or you will write cirrhosis of liver, what will happen? When we give this acetazolamide, this ammonia will come back into the blood, and this ammonia cannot be converted into urea. This ammonia will remain like ammonia, and this ammonia will go to the brain, and it causes brain damage. Ammonia is a very toxic molecule. So the first point is, these acetazolamide like drug or carbonic anhydrase enzyme, they cause ammonia retention, and they are absolutely contraindicated in patients of liver failure. Why? Because due to ammonia retention in liver failure, the ammonia will not be converted into urea. This ammonia will go into the brain, and it will damage brain. It will lead to hyperammonemic. It will lead to hyperammonemic encephalopathy. It will lead to hyperammonemic encephalopathy. So this ammonia will damage the brain. Brain damage is known as encephalopathy. So they are carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. They are absolutely contraindicated in liver failure. Second point, we know they cause sulfonamide allergy because their structures are sulfa containing. Okay, and the last point you will write, they cause electrolyte imbalance. They cause electrolyte imbalance in the blood. Now what electrolyte imbalance? We know that they decrease all ions in the urine. Can we say there will be potassium loss? Due to potassium loss, there will be hypokalemia. Okay, there will be bicarbonate lost in the into the urine. So there will be decreased blood potassium level because potassium is lost into the urine. Can we say they will decrease bicarbonate level in the blood? If bicarbonate is decreased in the blood, can we say relatively H plus ion will increase? Okay, so they will cause metabolic acidosis. Metabolic acidosis. Now can we say if in the blood bicarbonate ion is lost, who will take the place of bicarbonate? Who will supply this now negative charge? Remember, this negative charge is compensated by chloride. But chloride is not an alkaline substance. It will just give negative charge. So the level of chloride will increase to compensate for this bicarbonate in the blood. Hence, they will cause hyperchloremic. So they will cause hyperchloremic, hypokalemic, metabolic acidosis. Because they cause potassium loss in urine, they cause bicarbonate loss in urine. Due to bicarbonate loss, the pH of the blood will become acidic, and to compensate for this bicarbonate, the chloride ion will increase. Hence, this is their electrolyte disturbance which will occur in the blood. So carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, they cause hyperchloremic, hypokalemic, metabolic acidosis. Okay, chaliye. Now let's talk about the second diuretic. The second diuretic we have is loop diuretics. So let's talk about now the second diuretic, loop diuretic. Okay, so loop diuretic, you will write that these loop diuretic, they are the most effective or most efficacious diuretic we have. They are the most effective or most efficacious diuretic we have. Why? Because sir, these diuretic, they cause maximum sodium loss in urine. Okay, they cause maximum sodium loss in urine. So why they cause maximum sodium loss in urine? Because they were inhibiting sodium potassium 2 chloride channel. But remember one point, sir, acetazolamide or carbonic anhydrase enzyme, they are very weak diuretic. That we will discuss later. Very weak. Although they were acting at the area of PCT, and at the area of PCT we know maximum sodium gets reabsorbed, but the later part of the kidney compensate. That the subsequent part of the kidney, they compensate for the sodium loss in PCT. So loop diuretic becomes the most effective drug. Hence they are known as high ceiling diuretics. They are known as high ceiling diuretics. Why? Because they are the most effective diuretic we have. Okay, so let's see what is their mechanism of action. Now their main mechanism of action is, sir, they inhibit sodium potassium 2 chloride channel, 2 chloride transporter. In which area of the kidney? They inhibit sodium potassium 2 chloride channel in medullary portion of thick ascending limb. Okay, they inhibit sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter in medullary portion of thick ascending limb. But apart from this, loop diuretic, they have certain other additional mechanism of action as well. They have some additional mechanism of action. These loop diuretic, they increase prostaglandin synthesis. They increase prostaglandin synthesis in kidney, or prostaglandin levels will increase. Now remember, the blood which is coming to the kidney through glomerulus, can we say the blood was getting filtered into the PCT of the kidney? Remember, the prostaglandins which are synthesized by the kidney with the help of loop diuretic, they increase the blood supply to the kidney. They increase blood supply to the kidney. Why they will increase blood supply to the kidney? Because these prostaglandin, they dilate efferent arteries. Prostaglandin, they dilate efferent arteries. As efferent artery will get dilated, can we say more amount of the blood will come into the glomerulus, and more amount of the blood will be filtered into the glomerulus. So more amount of sodium and water will get filtered, and more amount of sodium and water will be lost out in urine. Okay, so what is the importance of increasing prostaglandin level? They increase GFR. GFR stands for glomerular filtration rate. Okay, and second point, sir, they produce vasodilatation in the body. They also produce vasodilatation in the body. Okay, so they increase prostaglandin level. Can you tell me some drug which inhibit prostaglandin production? There is one drug which inhibit prostaglandin formation. That class of drug is known as NSAID. The class of drug which inhibit prostaglandin production is known as NSAID, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug like aspirin, indomethacin, etc. Can we say that aspirin or indomethacin, they inhibit prostaglandin formation, while loop diuretic, they increase prostaglandin formation? Can we say that NSAIDs, they decrease the effect of loop diuretics? Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, they reduce the effect of loop diuretics because they reduce the filtration of sodium and water. Hence, if sodium and water will not be filtered, the diuretic action will be reduced. Now, second, the additional property of these drugs you will write will be, apart from this, so loop diuretic should not be combined with NSAID, okay? Because they reduce the effectiveness of loop diuretic. Loop diuretic increases prostaglandin level. NSAIDs, they reduce prostaglandin level, okay? Now, second point, remember, they also abolish cortico, medullary gradient. They also abolish corticomedullary gradient. Corticomedullary gradient is also known as countercurrent mechanism. If you remember, that countercurrent mechanism is responsible for reabsorption of water and mainly sodium, hai na? Because of this reason, they also cause water plus sodium loss. They cause water and sodium loss. Now remember, if the water is getting lost with along with sodium, you will write that these loop diuretic, they depress both positive and negative free water clearance. Okay, now free water clearance we will discuss in a subsequent video. It's a separate topic. So right now you just write this point. They abolish corticomedullary gradient, or the countercurrent mechanism. Countercurrent mechanism is responsible for reabsorption of water and sodium. So this water and sodium will be lost in urine. So just write loop diuretic, they reduce both positive and negative free water clearance. Okay, so these are the various mechanisms of loop diuretic. They inhibit sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter in the medullary portion of thick ascending limb. They also increase prostaglandin, and they abolish corticomedullary gradient or countercurrent mechanism. This also helps in loss of water and sodium. Okay, so these are the various mechanism of action of these drugs. Okay, chaliye, let's see what are the drugs we have among loop diuretics. So let's see, What are the drugs we have among loop diuretic? So you'll write that all these drugs, they can be given orally, they can be given IV, they can be given intramuscularly, intravenously, intramuscularly. So let's see what are the drugs we have. The first drug among loop diuretic which we made were mercury containing. They were mercury containing drugs. Okay, so these drugs which were mercury containing drugs, they were ether, crinic acid and mersalil. Okay, nowadays we don't prefer to use them. Nowadays we don't use them or very rarely use. Why? Because the mercury which is present in them, remember, it causes permanent ototoxicity. It is highly ototoxic. So person will become permanently deaf because of this mercury. So these drugs are highly ototoxic drug. A person will have irreversible ear damage. Hence we made other drugs. Loop diuretic. These loop diuretics are sulfonamides or sulfa containing drugs. They are now sulfa containing. That means they are not having mercury. Not mercury containing. Okay. So you will write these drugs as three drugs. The most commonly used drug is furosemide. It comes with the brand name Lasix. You can write other drug, torsemide. And a very good drug, bumetanide. Okay. So these are the sulfa containing drugs we have. So they are non-mercury. So basic question arises, will these drugs be ototoxic? Remember, these drugs are not ototoxic, but these drugs, they increase ototoxicity of other drugs. Now why they can cause ototoxicity of other drug? Because these drugs, they cause electrolyte imbalance. In endolymph of the ear. This electrolyte imbalance in the endolymph of ear damage hair cells of ear. Or hair cells of the ear which are floating in this endolymph. Now that is why these loop diuretics should not be combined with ototoxic drugs. So we will write the names of certain ototoxic drugs with which these loop diuretics should not be combined. Okay, so other ototoxic drug you will write, like certain antibiotics like vancomycin. You will write aminoglycosides, cisplatin and lastly you can write is amphotericin B. So these drugs are ototoxic drug. So their ototoxic potential will be increased by loop diuretics. Okay, so loop diuretic should not be combined with these ototoxic drugs. Okay, now the point is, let's talk about a little some properties about these drugs. So this furosemide is the most commonly used drug. Okay, but what about other drug? You will write torsemide. It is overall the longest acting drug. This bumetanide overall is the most potent drug. That means it required lesser dose. It is the most potent. It is 40 times more potent than furosemide. Okay, it is 40 times more potent than furosemide. So it's the most potent, required least dose. What about ethracycline? You will write ethracycline acid has 100% oral bioavailability. That means when it is given orally, it completely gets reabsorbed into the blood. Okay, so the most commonly used drug we have is furosemide. Torsemide is the longest acting, bumetanide is the most potent, and anthracyanic acid has 100% oral bioavailability. So keeping these things in mind, let's see the uses of these drugs now. Let's see the uses of loop diuretics. Okay, so let's see the uses of loop diuretics. The first point you will write, loop diuretics, they are the drug of choice for acute pulmonary edema. They are the drug of choice for acute pulmonary edema. Acute pulmonary edema means the blood is collected in the lungs. Can you tell me in which heart failure the blood will be collected in lungs? Which heart failure? From the lungs, you know, the blood goes into left ventricle. If there is left ventricular failure, can we say the left part of the heart is not beating? The fluid will be collected in lungs. It is also known as acute LVF. It is known as acute LVF. Now, how to treat it? Remember, the blood which is coming to the right heart through these veins will go to the lungs. We know that from right heart, the blood which comes through the veins, it goes to the lungs. If we decrease the blood supply to the lung, slowly and slowly this edema will be cured. Now, what is the mechanism of action of loop diuretics in acute pulmonary edema? Their main mechanism of action is they are venodilators. They are venodilators. Why they produce venodilation? Because they increase prostaglandin production. Because of venodilation, what happens? The blood supply to the lungs decreases. There will be decrease blood supply to heart. Okay, which is known as decrease in preload. If there is decrease in blood supply to the heart, slowly and slowly the blood which was collected in lungs will be shifted into, slowly and slowly it will be shifted into the systemic circulation. So it will shift the blood. The blood will shift from pulmonary circulation to heart or systemic circulation, slowly and slowly. So it will provide a massive relief in this case. Okay, so that is why they are used in acute pulmonary edema. So loop diuretic, they are the drug of choice for acute pulmonary edema. Okay, remember this part. Sir, what is the treatment of acute pulmonary edema? Why they are using? Because loop diuretic, they have venodilators. It is because of vasodilatation or venodilating action. If the symptoms are not controlled by loop diuretic in acute pulmonary edema, we add a drug, morphine. We add a drug, morphine. Now I am telling you the treatment of acute pulmonary edema. Why morphine? Because loop diuretic was a venodilator, morphine is also a venodilator. If it is still not controlled, we add nitroglycerin. Sir, why nitroglycerin? Because nitroglycerin is also a venodilator. But the drug of choice for acute pulmonary edema, remember, will be loop diuretics. Okay, loop diuretics, they are the drug of choice. Now, second point with these diuretic, loop diuretic, second use you will write, they are also used in other refractory edemas. They are used in other refractory edemas. So let's talk about the treatment of all edema here only. Okay, so let's talk about certain edemas. So refractory edema, it is generally seen in cases of some organ failure. In cases of some organ damage, we find some refractory edema. Okay, so let's see what are the organ damage which leads to refractory edema. You will write first CHF. CHF stands for congestive heart failure. Just write the word severe. Okay, second you will write CKD. CKD stands for chronic kidney disease, kidney failure. And lastly, nephrotic syndrome. Nephrotic syndrome. So in these conditions, we find edema very commonly. Okay, now just write certain other areas where edema is seen, you will write mild CHF. In case of liver damage, you will write cirrhosis. And lastly, cerebral edema because of increase in intracranial pressure or in cases of head injury. Okay, now let's see what are the drug of choice. In severe CHF, CKD, chronic kidney disease or nephrotic syndrome, if there is edema, the drug of choice is loop diuretics. The drug of choice is loop diuretics because they will cause massive fluid loss. In mild CHF, the drug of choice is thiazides. The drug of choice is thiazides. In liver cirrhosis, cirrhosis is the damage of liver, the drug of choice is spironolactone. And in cerebral edema, remember the drug of choice is one more diuretic I will be telling you shortly, will be mannitol. Okay, mannitol. These are the drug of choice. Now remember a very important part, if they are not able to produce effect, then we have to eventually start loop diuretic. So in refractory cases, we start loop diuretic. Okay, so this is the treatment of edema, you must remember. So in refractory cases, we start this drug. Okay, so in severe CHF, kidney failure, nephrotic syndrome. So in kidney failure, the diuretic of choice we have is loop diuretics. Remember this part. In mild CHF, we can give thiazides. Liver cirrhosis, spironolactone. And cerebral edema, mannitol. In resistant cases, we start loop diuretics. Okay? Loop diuretic. Now let's talk about the third use of loop diuretic. Remember, they are used in the treatment of, they are the drug of choice for hypercalcemia. Okay, they are also used in the treatment of hyperkalemia. They are also used for the treatment of hyperkalemia. Okay, why? Because loop diuretics, they loses all iron. Loop loses all. That means they will lose all iron in urine. Hence the blood level of these ions will decrease. So you will write loop diuretic, they lose sodium into the urine. They remove all the positively charged ions, you can write blindly. They lose all iron. So can we say if in the blood the level of potassium is very high, that is known as hyperkalemia, this potassium will be lost out in urine. So they are used for the treatment of hyperkalemia. If the level of calcium is very high, they are the drug of choice for hypercalcemia. Okay, so the diuretic of choice in hypercalcemia and hyperkalemia is loop diuretic. They lose all ions in the urine. They lose all ions in the urine. Okay, so remember this part. Now let's move forward. Sir, what is overall the treatment of hypercalcemia? What is the treatment of hypercalcemia? Let's understand this part. The treatment of hypercalcemia is, when the patient of hypercalcemia comes to us, we give intravenous saline plus loop diuretics like furosemide. Okay, after that we start calcitonin with bisphosphonates. Calcitonin and bisphosphonate, they will make this calcium go into the bones. They will make this calcium which is present in the blood deposited in the bone. Okay, so remember this part. So this is the treatment of hypercalcemia. Okay, so we give loop diuretic, after that we give calcitonin and bisphosphonates as well. Okay, we will discuss the treatment of hyperkalemia shortly. Okay, chali. The last use of loop diuretic is hypertension. Okay, But remember, in hypertension, the drug of choice is not loop. The drug of choice for hypertension is thiazides. The drug of choice for hypertension among diuretic is not loop diuretic, thiazides. Why? Because thiazides, they are generally very long acting drugs. They are very long acting drugs. What about loop? Loop, they are very short acting drug. Okay, they are very short acting drug, and hypertension is a very lifelong disease. Okay, so they are very short acting drug. So they generally reduce blood pressure for very long, short duration of time, not in the long term. Okay, so where they are used generally, if thiazides are unable to control BP, we generally give spironolactone or potassium sparing diuretic. If it is still not controlled, then we can add loop. Then we can add loop only for short term. Okay? Because of this reason, we only use, the most commonly use is torsemide. Because torsemide among loop diuretic is the longest acting drug, it will reduce the blood pressure for long duration of time. And the point is the tolerance. If we use a drug which is a very short acting drug, what happens? Body tolerate. The body develops tolerance against that drug very rapidly. Tolerance against torsemide is not developed very rapidly. So for hypertension, we commonly use torsemide because it will produce a sustained effect. Okay, sustained effect. Now let's move forward. Let's talk about now, what are the side effect of loop diuretics? Okay, let's talk about the side effect of loop diuretics. Now, the first side effect you will write of loop diuretic is loop diuretic causes electrolyte imbalance. In blood. Okay. Now what electrolyte imbalance they will cause in blood? We have already written that loop loses all ions in urine. Hence, the blood level of all ions will decrease. Can we say they will decrease sodium level in the blood? They will decrease potassium. They will decrease H+. They will decrease calcium and they will decrease magnesium. The loop diuretic reduces all ions in the blood. They also reduce the chloride and phosphate level as well. Okay, they also reduce chloride and phosphate. Now let's see what can happen. Okay, what can happen? So this is the most common effect. As we know, they are causing sodium loss because they are diuretic. Because of this reason, they may cause acute hyponatremia, which can be very dangerous condition. They may cause acute hyponatremia or acute hypotension. Because of sodium loss, decrease in sodium level in the blood, they may cause acute hyponatremia or acute hypotension. Now, in the blood, they cause hypokalemia. Now, as they are causing hypokalemia, remember hypokalemia presents as muscle weakness and muscle cramps. Okay? And hypokalemia increases the toxicity of one drug. You will write digoxin toxicity will be increased because hypokalemia causes digoxin toxicity. As they are decreasing H plus level in the blood, you can write that they may cause slight metabolic alkalosis. As they are decreasing calcium, they may cause hypocalcemia. But this hypocalcemia is non-significant. Why? Because as the blood level of calcium decreases, GIT and bone compensate for this calcium. GIT and bone compensate for this calcium, so the hypocalcemia is very non-significant and least seen. It is least seen, very less seen. Okay, as it will cause decrease in magnesium, it will cause hypomagnesemia. It may cause hypomagnesemia. Now, hypomagnesemia causes one side effect. You will write pseudo gout. It causes pseudo gout, which is also known as chondrocalcinosis. Chondrocalcinosis is a side effect, or pseudo gout is a side effect of loop diuretics. Okay, loop diuretic. Now, what are the other electrolyte imbalance you will write in the blood? Inside the blood, they cause hyperuricemia. They cause hyperuricemia. That means level of uric acid will increase. They also cause hyperglycemia. That means the level of blood glucose will increase in the blood. And lastly, you will write they cause hyperlipidemia. Hyperlipidemia, that means lipid level or lipoproteins level in the blood will increase. Okay, now why these levels are increased? All these levels are increased to compensate for this loss. The blood will increase to maintain the osmolarity. The blood will increase uric acid, glucose and other proteins level. Okay, so remember, can we say that they are increasing uric acid level, they can precipitate gout. Okay, and as they are increasing glucose level, they are bad for diabetes, and they increases lipid level, they are bad for dyslipidemia patient. Okay, so remember this part. Now, before going further, sir, there is one more diuretic which produces same effect. That diuretic is thiazide. The next diuretic which we'll be discussing will be thiazides. Thiazide also produces all these effects, except thiazide, instead of losing all ions in urine, thiazides preserve calcium. Hence, one effect of thiazide will not be seen. This calcium. Thiazides do not cause hypocalcemia. With thiazide, you will just write one point. Thiazides will rather cause hypercalcemia. Hypercalcemia. That means inside the blood, they will increase calcium level. Only this is the difference you will write with thiazide. Rest everything is seen along with thiazide diuretic as well. They will also cause decrease in sodium. They also cause hypokalemia. They also cause metabolic acidosis, hypomagnesemia. They also cause uric acid, glucose and lipid level increase, except calcium. Thiazides, they will preserve calcium from the kidney. So you will write that loop diuretic, they lose calcium. Thiazide, they will preserve calcium. So now let's talk about thiazide diuretic. So what is the mechanism of action of thiazides? We know that thiazide, they inhibit sodium chloride symporter. In which portion of the kidney? In cortical portion of distal tubule. And we know that this distal tubule was formed by two parts of the kidney. One was thick ascending limb in the cortical portion. And early part of DCT. So it inhibits sodium chloride symporter. Now, remember, these thiazides, they have weak
कार्बोनिक एनहाइड्रेज इनहिबिटिंग प्रॉपर्टी ऑल्सो लाइक एसिटाजोलामाइड, बट इट्स वेरी वीक, नॉन सिग्निफिकेंट फॉर अस. सो दे आर वीक कार्बोनिक एनहाइड्रेज इनहिबिटर ऑल्सो एक्सेप्ट इंडपामाइड. सो देर विल बी वन थाइजाइड विच डज नॉट हैव दिस प्रॉपर्टी, दैट इज इंडपामाइड. सो कीपिंग दिस थिंग्स इन माइंड, लेट्स टॉक अबाउट वट आर द वेरियस ड्रग्स वी हैव अमंग दीज डायूरेटिक्स. ओके, let's talk about thiazide drugs. Now, unlike loop diuretics, they are only given orally. There is no injectable preparation we have. Loop diuretics, they can be given by injections as well, but thiazides, they are only given by oral route. So let's talk about what are the drugs we have among thiazides. So you're right, the first class of drugs, we call them as just thiazides. The second class of drug, we call them as thiazide-like, because the structure is different. Rest everything is same, only the structural differences are there. Among thiazides, you will write hydrochlorothiazide, benzthiazide, chlorothiazide. Lastly, you can write one more drug, bendroflumethiazide. Okay, so how we can remember? You are seeing that all these drugs, they are ending with the word thiazide. They all are ending with the word thiazide. So you just have to identify them, and it's very easy to identify them. Now, among thiazide like, you will write the drug chlorothalidone. They will not end with the word thiazide. Chlorothalidone. Second you will write is metazolone. Other drugs you will write are indapamide, zepamide, and clopamide. Okay, so you are seeing they are ending with the word on and amide. Okay, so this is thiazide like, they will not end with the word thiazide. Now before going further, just write one point about these drugs. So this chlorothalidone, overall it is the longest acting thiazide. Overall is chlorothalidone. Indapamide, you will write it is the most potent, means it requires least dose. Okay, next you will write that this bendroflumethiazide, the longest name, it will have 100% oral absorption or oral bioavailability, that when it is given orally, it is completely absorbed. Okay, remember this part. Now just one point, sir, all these diuretic, they are contraindicated, or they are not effective, that is why they are contraindicated. They are not effective in kidney failure. They are not effective in kidney failure, or you will write CKD. I told you that in CKD, the drug of choice to control that edema was loop diuretic. There, the drug of choice was loop diuretic. Okay, but there is one diuretic, no thiazide is effective in kidney failure except metazolone. Metazolone can be given in kidney failure. Metazolone is the only thiazide which is effective in kidney failure. Because of this reason, it is given as an add-on drug to loop. It is given as an add-on drug to loop diuretic in cases of kidney failure to control edema. Okay, to control edema, we give them. Okay, now let's see what are the uses of thiazide diuretic we know. Okay, so the first use of thiazide we will write is they are the drug of choice for the treatment of hypertension. Thiazides, they are the drug of choice for hypertension. okay, according to a criteria which we will discuss in hypertension, JNC criteria. For hypertension, we follow JNC criteria, JNC 8 criteria. These guidelines we follow. Okay, now what is their mechanism of action in hypertension? Why they are given in hypertension? It is not because of fluid loss. When we give thiazide diuretic, thiazides, they cause persistent sodium loss. They cause persistent sodium loss in urine. Okay, because of this reason, they create sodium deficiency state in the body. There will be sodium deficiency in the body. Now remember, when there is sodium deficiency in the body, there is gradual vasodilatation. The vessels in our body, they gradually vasodilate. Because of this reason, if the vessels will dilate slowly and slowly, the total peripheral resistance will decrease. Total peripheral resistance will decrease. Okay? Which is a component of diastolic blood pressure. So diastolic blood pressure will decrease. So remember, what is their mechanism of action in for the treatment of hypertension? In one word, it is vasodilatation. So they cause vasodilatation, the blood vessels will dilate. Why it will dilate? Because of sodium deficiency. Okay, so the most commonly used thiazides in hypertension, you will write, the most commonly used thiazide is chlorthalidone, the longest acting. Okay, so it is an approved drug by our guideline, JNC guideline. Also, hydrochlorothiazide is used. And lastly, indapamide is used. These are the most commonly used thiazide for the treatment of hypertension. Okay, among them, most commonly we use chlorthalidone. Why? It is the longest acting. Now, the second use of thiazide is, it is used in edema. That we have discussed in loop part, in cases of mild CHF. In heart failure, CHF stand for congestive heart failure, we can give thiazide if there is mild edema. In severe, we give loop diuretic. Now the third use of loop diuretic is, sir, they are the drug of choice in nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Okay, they are the drug of choice in nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Now what is diabetes insipidus? We will write, diabetes insipidus, it's a condition in which in our body there is no effect of one hormone known as ADH hormone. The ADH hormone is not functioning. As the ADH hormone is not functioning, the kidney will not able to concentrate urine, water is passed out in urine. Now there are two causes of diabetes insipidus. The first cause of diabetes insipidus is central DI, central or neurogenic diabetes insipidus. Neurogenic or central means, in central nervous system, the neurons of hypothalamus, they secrete ADH. What happens? There is some defect in CNS or neurons, there is no ADH secretion in the body. There is no ADH secretion in the body. Okay, now there is one more cause of diabetes insipidus. This ADH hormone, it acts on kidney. So when it acts on kidney, it acts on some receptors. When the kidney receptors are not responding, it is known as nephrogenic DI. Nephrogenic means, nephrogenic diabetes insipidus means, in this case, the ADH receptors, which are V2 receptors in kidney, they are defective. That is why it is known as nephrogenic. Now, what is the treatment? Remember, in diabetes insipidus, as we are seeing, the first one, in the body, there is no ADH. The drug of choice is exogenous ADH. Give ADH from outside. Give exogenous ADH or vasopressin. ADH is also known as vasopressin. Give vasopressin from outside. So we give one synthetic vasopressin. That drug of choice is, that synthetic vasopressin, which is the drug of choice in central DI, is desmopressin. So this desmopressin we give for the treatment of central or neurogenic DI. because there is no ADH, supply this ADH from the outside, and this synthetic ADH hormone, ADH is also known as vasopressin, is known as desmopressin. We given this. But my question from you is, does this desmopressin or ADH hormone will be effective in nephrogenic DI? Will it be effective? In nephrogenic DI, the receptors of ADH are defective. So remember, there is no role of ADH hormone. There is no role of vasopressin. Because the receptors are defective, they will not respond to desmopressin. So now, what is the treatment of nephrogenic DI? You will write, the drug of choice for the treatment of nephrogenic DI is thiazide diuretic. The drug of choice is thiazide diuretics. Okay, but what about, can we give thiazides in central DI? The answer is yes, it is found to be effective. It is effective, but it is not the drug of choice. Thiazides, they can be given in central DI, okay, but the drug of choice in central DI is desmopressin. Desmopressin has no role in nephrogenic DI. Here the drug of choice is thiazide. Thiazides are also effective in central DI also, okay. Now, what is the role of thiazides in diabetes insipidus? Now, what happens if there is no ADH in the body? What happens? The function of ADH hormone is to reabsorb water back into the blood. So, if this ADH will not able to act inside the urine, remember, the in urine, the amount of water becomes very high because ADH generally preserve water, and the sodium level becomes very less. Okay. So, what happens in diabetes insipidus? The patient passes out dilute urine. Why dilute urine? Because the water is not reabsorbed because there is no ADH. Okay. Now, can we say the water is getting more cleared as compared to sodium? As the water is getting more removed as compared to sodium, what happens in diabetes insipidus? There is increase in positive free water clearance. We write one term, positive free water clearance. That means in cases of diabetes insipidus, the water is getting removed very high, sodium is less getting removed, so the patient is passing out dilute urine, so water clearance has been increased, water is getting more removed. Now, when we give thiazide, remember, thiazide diuretic, they mainly cause sodium loss. Thiazides, they mainly cause sodium loss, very less water loss. Okay, very less water loss. Can we say it will create an opposite situation? They will create an opposite situation. Because of this reason, thiazides, they reduce positive free water clearance. They will reduce positive free water clearance. Can we say the amount of water will get decreased? In this case, when we give thiazides in cases of diabetes insipidus, the amount of water which is coming into the urine will decrease. Because of reduction in water, there will be decrease in urinary volume. There will be decrease in urinary volume or urinary flow. Okay. So, in this case, the person will come to you with diabetes insipidus with polyuria. When we give thiazide, this polyuria will be stopped because now the kidney is mainly removing sodium, water is preserved because of thiazide. Thiazide, they cause sodium loss, they preserve water in a kind. Okay. So, because of this reason, they decrease urinary volume. Any drug which decreases urinary volume is an antidiuretic. So, remember, thiazides, they act as an thiazide diuretic, they become antidiuretic in case of diabetes insipidus. Normally they are diuretic, but in diabetes insipidus they act as an antidiuretic. Why? They mainly cause sodium loss, less of water loss. What happens in diabetes insipidus? There is more of water loss, less of sodium loss. Okay. So, they reduce positive free water clearance in cases of diabetes insipidus. So, this is their use in DI. So, they are the drug of choice in nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Remember that part. So they are the drug of choice for nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Now the last use of thiazide we will write is thiazides. They are also used for the treatment of hypercalciuria. Now, in the loop section, we have discussed that thiazides, they lose all iron in urine except calcium. That means thiazides, they preserve calcium. Can we say that this calcium will not be excreted out in urine? So there is a condition known as hypercalciuria. Hypercalciuria means the kidney is excreting high amount of calcium in the urine. So what is hypercalciuria? Calcium excretion in urine. So can we say that thiazide, they preserve calcium, hence they will inhibit calcium excretion out in urine. These thiazides, they inhibit calcium excretion in urine. Okay, so they inhibit calcium. Now where do we want to inhibit calcium excretion? So this hypercalciuria, it generally causes, when this calcium gets excreted out in urine, can we say that this calcium may get deposited anywhere from kidney? From kidney it may get deposited in ureter, bladder. So if this calcium is getting removed out in urine, this hypercalciuria causes renal stones. Because of this reason, thiazides, they preserve calcium. Hence, thiazides, they are used for the treatment of renal stones. And which stones? Calcium stones. Okay? Renal stones or calcium stones. So there is one condition where they have become the drug of choice. They have become the drug of choice of renal stone in case of idiopathic, that means we don't know, hypercalciuria. They have become the drug of choice for idiopathic hypercalciuria, in which the kidney is removing high amount of calcium in urine. And in idiopathic hypercalciuria, patient suffers from renal stone. So thiazide, they will prevent renal stone. This idiopathic hypercalciuria is also known as Dent disease. Okay. Now the second use of these thiazide, as they are preserving calcium, can we say they are good for osteoporosis? Because in cases of osteoporosis, there is calcium deficiency in the body. So they will preserve calcium in the body. And this calcium increases bone mineral density. Hence, they are the antihypertensive, which are good in osteoporosis. Okay. Now let's talk about the side effects of thiazides. So remember, thiazides, their side effect, we have already discussed, they were similar to loop. So you will write, the first side effect is electrolyte imbalance. Okay, so we will write thiazide lose all iron. All except calcium. So what will happen? We will write, the first will, can we say, so they will lose all ions, so they will cause loss of potassium, there will be loss of magnesium, there will be loss of hydrogen. Except they will increase calcium. Okay, they will increase calcium. So these effects are just like loop-like. Okay, loop-like effect. So they also cause hypokalemia. hypomagnesemia, just like loop, and they cause metabolic alkalosis. Okay, but they will, unlike loop, they will cause hypercalcemia. Okay, so loop causes hypocalcemia, thiazides they cause hypercalcemia. Okay, now the second point is they cause impotency. Now, which diuretics they cause impotency? All right, impotency is caused by thiazides. And one diuretic which I will be telling you shortly, that is spironolactone. These two diuretics, they cause impotency. Remember, loop do not cause impotency. Loop diuretic, no impotency. And the rest side effect of thiazides are again similar to loop, which we have already discussed. As all these ions are reduced in the body, to compensate for this ion, thiazide diuretic, they cause hyperglycemia. They inhibit insulin secretion. Okay, they cause hyperuricemia. That means they may cause precipitate gout. They may cause hyperlipidemia. They may cause hyperlipidemia. Okay, so these are also like loop. Okay, like loop. So remember this part. The only difference with thiazide and loop is thiazide they cause impotency, loop do not cause impotency, and thiazide they preserve calcium, loop loses calcium. Okay, loop loses all iron. So last diuretic, the last diuretic which is acting at the level of collecting duct, now we will write, will be endosterone. We will write the diuretic is potassium sparing diuretic. The last class of diuretic which is acting on collecting duct is potassium sparing diuretic. After that we will discuss a very novel diuretic, that will be osmotic diuretic. So let's talk about first potassium sparing diuretic. Okay, now what is their mechanism of action? Potassium sparing diuretic, they inhibit the action of aldosterone. They inhibit aldosterone action. In which portion? We know that aldosterone act on late part of DCT, distal convoluted tubule, and collecting duct. So it will inhibit the aldosterone action in late part of distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct. Now let's see what are the drugs we have. In this, we have two kinds of drug which can inhibit aldosterone action. The first drug we have, which will block aldosterone receptors. The first class of drug we have that will block aldosterone receptor. Okay, these drugs are known as aldosterone antagonist. Antagonist means blockers. The first class of drug among potassium sparing diuretic we have is aldosterone antagonist. The second drug we have which will block aldosterone induced proteins. Aldosterone produces certain protein which causes reabsorption of sodium. So I will be telling you that protein shortly. Okay, that protein is known as ENaC. Which protein is formed by aldosterone? ENaC protein. So these drugs are known as ENaC inhibitors. Okay, ENaC inhibitors. What is ENaC? That full form we will discuss. That will be epithelial sodium channel shortly. Now let's see what are the differences between these two drugs. Remember, these aldosterone receptor antagonists, they act through basolateral membrane. They act through basolateral side. While all diuretic, including ENaC inhibitor, they act through luminal side. You'll write also rest all other diuretics, they also act from luminal side. The only diuretic which acts through basolateral side is aldosterone antagonist. Okay. Now, let's see what do we mean by this point. Let's see what is the role of aldosterone on collecting duct, how it reabsorbs sodium and how we inhibit this. So suppose this is the collecting duct of the kidney and here the sodium is coming. Okay. Now, this is the lumen of the kidney. This is the lumen of the kidney and sodium is getting removed out in urine. And here we have certain cells. These cells are known as P cells. We have certain cells known as P cells. P cells are also known as principal cells. Okay. Now what happens on the basolateral side? So this part is the lumen. So this part is known as luminal side. And behind this lumen side, the basolateral side, from here we have a blood vessel. Here we have a blood vessel. This is known as basolateral side. Okay. Now in our blood, we have one hormone. We have one hormone in our blood known as aldosterone. So this aldosterone goes inside the cells of P cells. They go inside this P cell. And this aldosterone act on receptors. We know that steroidal hormones, they have receptor in cytoplasm. So it act on a receptor known as aldosterone receptor. Now when it acts on aldosterone receptor, this receptor goes to the genes and these genes, they synthesize one protein. They synthesize one protein that is known as aldosterone. When it acts on its receptor, this receptor will go to the genes. It will attach to the gene and gene will synthesize one protein. This protein is known as ENaC protein. ENaC stands for epithelial sodium channel. The full form of ENaC is epithelial sodium channel. So this protein is formed. Let's suppose this protein is blue in color. So this protein will be formed and this ENaC protein will come on the epithelial surface of P cells. It will come on the epithelial surface of P cell ENaC protein. Now when the sodium is coming, remember this sodium gets reabsorbed through this ENaC protein. This sodium gets reabsorbed from this ENaC protein. That is how aldosterone helps in sodium reabsorption. Can we say when this sodium will get reabsorbed into the cell, the positive charge inside the cell will increase? The positive charge inside the cell will increase. What will happen? To maintain the positive charge, potassium will give sacrifice. Potassium will give sacrifice. Okay? Potassium. Now this potassium will go into the urine. Okay? But remember, suppose there is 100 molecules of potassium, body cannot afford the loss of high amount of potassium. Some amount of potassium, it gets reabsorbed and some amount of potassium gets excreted out in urine. When some amount of potassium gets reabsorbed, one molecule will give sacrifice for this potassium, that will be H+. To retain some amount of potassium, H+ will be excreted out in urine. So can we say when sodium is getting reabsorbed, instead of sodium, hydrogen and potassium are giving sacrifice. Now we have two classes of drug. The first class of drug that will inhibit this aldosterone receptor, they are known as aldosterone antagonist. And second class of drug we have is ENaC inhibitor. Can we say that ENaC inhibitor, they will act through which membrane? Can you tell me ENaC inhibitor, they will act from which side of the cell? ENaC inhibitor, they will come from the kidney like sodium and they will inhibit this ENaC channel through luminal side. This is the luminal side. While aldosterone receptor antagonist, they are analogs of aldosterone. They will come like aldosterone and they will block aldosterone receptor inside the cell. So aldosterone receptor antagonist, they will act through basolateral side, they will come into the blood. Okay, so if they are inhibiting this receptors or channel, what will happen? Sodium will not be reabsorbed. If sodium will be not be reabsorbed, sodium will be excreted out in urine. If sodium will not be excreted out in urine, can we say that hydrogen and potassium will be preserved? Hydrogen and potassium will be preserved, hence they are known as potassium sparing diuretics. Hence they are known as potassium sparing diuretic. Because if the sodium will not get reabsorbed, potassium and hydrogen will not have to give sacrifice. Okay, सो दैट इज वाई. तो लेट्स टॉक अबाउट वट आर द ड्रग्स वी हैव. तो अमंग एल्डोस्टेरोन रिसेप्टर एंटागनिस्ट वी हैव टू ड्रग्स. यू विल राइट द निमोनिक. द निमोनिक यू विल राइट अमंग एल्डोस्टेरोन एंटागनिस्ट एंड अमंग ईनैक इनहिबिटर्स. सो द ड्रग्स यू विल राइट इज सीट. ऑल दीज ड्रग्स आर पोटेशियम चैनल ब्लॉकर्स. ओके ऑल दीज ड्रग्स आर पोटेशियम सॉरी पोटेशियम स्पेरिंग डायूरेटिक. सो एस स्टैंड्स फॉर स्पायरोनोलेक्टॉन. सो इट्स एन एल्डोस्टेरोन रिसेप्टर एंटागनिस्ट. सेकेंड ड्रग वी हैव इज ई फॉर एप्लीरिनॉन. Eplirinone. Then we have ENaC inhibitors. ENaC inhibitors we have which will act through luminal side amiloride. And the next drug you will write is triamterene. Okay, triamterene. So these are the drugs we have among potassium sparing diuretic. Let's talk about first these aldosterone receptor antagonists. First we will talk about them. After that we will come to ENaC inhibitors. So let's talk about potassium. First aldosterone antagonist. This spironolactone and eplirinone, they both are converted into active metabolite. Their active metabolite is canrinone. And this canrinone is the main species that will block aldosterone receptors. Okay, so this canrinone will block aldosterone receptor. Okay, so they first get converted into active form. Now, what is the difference between these two drugs? So, spironolactone will block aldosterone receptor, but this spironolactone can block. It can also block. Testosterone receptor. So testosterone receptor is just like aldosterone receptor, while eplirinone will not produce any such kind of effect. Okay. Now, as it is blocking testosterone receptor, it will become a very bad drug for males. Because of blockage of testosterone receptor, the testosterone will not able to act. This drug causes gynecomastia in males and it causes impotency. It becomes a good drug for female. Why? It can be used for the treatment of high level of testosterone in females. It can be used for the treatment of hirsutism. It can be given for the treatment of hirsutism. Okay, because hirsutism is seen in females because of high level of testosterone in females. It causes facial hair growth just like males. Okay, so remember this part. Now let's see what are the uses of aldosterone antagonists spironolactone and eplirinone. Let's see first what are their uses. Okay, so if we talk about their uses, the first use is they are used in resistant cases of other diuretic. If there is resistance to some other diuretic, then we add spironolactone. Now which diuretic? If there is resistance to loop and thiazide, to overcome that resistance we add these potassium sparing diuretic as well. Okay, now the point is, what is the advantage? The first advantage of combining this potassium sparing diuretic with loop and thiazide is they improve efficacy. They improve their efficacy. And second advantage you will write, sir, these loop and thiazide, they cause one side effect. Loop and thiazide, they cause hypokalemia, which is a dangerous thing. While these potassium sparing diuretic like spironolactone and eplirinone, they cause hyperkalemia. So they are given to neutralize this side effect of hypokalemia due to loop and thiazide. Because potassium sparing, they cause hyperkalemia. Loop and thiazides, they cause hypokalemia. So these are the two reasons why we add potassium sparing diuretic to loop and thiazide. The first is to improve their effectiveness, and second to neutralize their side effect of hypokalemia. Okay, because they cause hyperkalemia, they preserve potassium. Second, they are used in resistant hypertension. Resistant hypertension, they are the drug of choice. Okay, third, you will write they are used in resistant edema. Now, which resistant edema? Which we have already discussed under loop section, edema due to cirrhosis of liver, which is sometimes known as, that edema is sometimes known as ascites. Okay, ascites. They are also the drug of choice for hyperaldosteronism. Hyperaldosteronism, it has two causes. Hyperaldosteronism means in the body there is increase in level of aldosterone hormone. It has two causes. Either, sir, there is a tumor of adrenal gland, increased production due to tumor. Okay, so that is known as primary hyperaldosteronism. Primary hyperaldosteronism. The drug of choice is spironolactone or eplerenone. This disease is also known as Kohn's disease. So they are the drug of choice for Kohn's disease. What happens in adrenal cortex? There is a tumor, so there is increased production of aldosterone. The second cause you will write is increased production due to RAS system. That means renin angiotensin aldosterone system. Okay, so here the adrenal gland is absolutely normal. In the first part, adrenal gland is having tumor, it is excessively producing. Here the adrenal gland is absolutely normal, but the renin and angiotensin, these renin and angiotensin, they are stimulating this adrenal gland and it is producing high amount of aldosterone. So this is known as secondary hyperaldosteronism. This is known as secondary hyperaldosteronism. Okay, now what is the difference between these two symptoms? Remember, in primary hyperaldosteronism you will see there will be no edema. In primary hyperaldosteronism there is no edema because our body releases natriuretic peptides. These natriuretic peptides, they do not allow the aldosterone to produce edema. Okay, but what happens in secondary hyperaldosteronism? It occurs. Why? There is RAS activity. There is increase in RAS activity in cases of CHF, heart failure. There is increase in activity of RAS system in cases of cirrhosis of liver. Okay, because the blood supply to the vital organ decreases, hence kidney produces high amount of renin and aldosterone. Now these CHF and cirrhosis, it leads to anasarca. And cirrhosis of liver leads to ascites, and these two conditions are known as resistant edema. Hence, in these two resistant edemas, we very commonly give spironolactone, especially of this cirrhosis of liver. The drug of choice is secondary hyperaldosteronism is spironolactone. Okay, spironolactone. It is also given in CHF as well. Okay, CHF. Okay, so remember, it is given in CHF, it is given in cirrhosis of liver because it has resistant edema. It is also given in Kohn's disease, although there is no edema, but it is given. Okay, so let's move further. Let's talk about the side effect of spironolactone and eplerenone. Sir, their most dangerous side effect is, the most dangerous side effect of spironolactone and potassium sparing diuretic is hyperkalemia. They preserve potassium, it may lead to hyperkalemia. Okay, and this hyperkalemia will become dangerous. It will become dangerous, more dangerous, when this spironolactone, or you will write these potassium sparing diuretics, they are combined with other drugs which may themselves may cause hyperkalemia. So what are the other drugs which may cause hyperkalemia? You will write, You will write first drug is ACE inhibitors like captopril. All ACE inhibitor, they will end with the word pril. Okay, you will write AT1 receptor blocker. They also cause hyperkalemia. Okay, and all these drugs, they end with the word sartan. Example, you can write losartan. Okay, second, you can write beta blockers. They also cause hyperkalemia. All beta blockers, they will end with the word LOL, LOL. So you can write any drug like etinolol, etc. Then you will write cyclosporin. Cyclosporin is an immunosuppressive drug. It causes hyperkalemia due to kidney damage. And the last point you will write is CKD. These things, they themselves are risk factor for hyperkalemia. So, potassium sparing diuretic, either they should not be combined with these drugs, or if you are combining, you have to monitor serum potassium level, because hyperkalemia patient may suddenly die due to arrhythmias. So either these potassium sparing diuretics should not be combined with ACE inhibitor or ARB, or even if you are combining, you have to monitor serum potassium level. Okay, now what are the other side effects? Other side effect you can write, they cause peptic ulcers and they cause, remember, they cause electrolyte imbalance. Now you will write that these drugs, they cause sodium loss, that is why they are potassium, they are known as diuretic, but they preserve all iron. They preserve all ions. So what happens in the blood? The level of potassium increases, the level of H plus increases, and the slight level of calcium and magnesium increases. So remember, they only cause sodium loss while they preserve all ions. Because of this reason, they cause hyperkalemia. They may cause metabolic acidosis in the blood. Okay, and they also retain calcium and magnesium, but it is not a very significant effect. Okay, now let's move further. The next diuretic we have is ENaC inhibitors. Now what does ENaC stand for? We already know ENaC stand for epithelial sodium channel. They are also known as amiloride sensitive channel. They are also known as amiloride sensitive channel. So let's see what are the drugs we have among it, these drugs which are ENaC inhibitor. You'll write two drugs are there, amiloride and triamterene. Amiloride and triamterene. Let's see first what is the difference between these two drugs. Okay, amiloride, you will write, amiloride is more potent, that means it required lesser dose and it is longer acting. It is longer acting. What about triamterene? Triamterene is a very toxic drug. It's a very toxic drug. That is why it is very less preferred or not used. Okay, very rarely used. Let's see what are the side effects of this triamterene. Remember, triamterene causes folic acid deficiency. Why? The structure of triamterene is just like a false folic acid. Okay, it also causes renal stones. Okay, it causes permanent kidney damage, which is known as interstitial nephritis, and it also causes photosensitivity. Photosensitivity. So just remember the mnemonic FRIP. Because of these reasons, we don't prefer to give this triamterene. It causes permanent kidney damage, which is interstitial nephritis. That's a very dangerous side effect. Because of this reason, by default, amiloride is a more preferred drug. Okay? It is the more preferred drug. So where amiloride is used, you will write amiloride. It is the drug of choice for Liddle syndrome. It is a drug of choice for Liddle syndrome. Now, what is Liddle syndrome? Liddle syndrome is a genetic disease in which in kidney there is very high amount of ENaC channel expression occurs. There is why high amount of ENaC channel it becomes in kidney. Okay, it is also the drug of choice for lithium toxicity. Or you will write lithium induced diabetes insipidus. Now remember, amiloride is the only ion, you will write, that potassium sparing diuretic like amiloride. They promote lithium excretion in urine. They promote lithium excretion in urine. Remember, lithium is just like sodium. Lithium in our body, it gets reabsorbed back into the blood. It gets reabsorbed back into the blood by ENaC. Okay? So if we will inhibit ENaC, remember lithium will be removed. But what about other diuretic? Remember all other diuretic like carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, like acetazolamide, loop diuretics, and thiazides. All other diuretics, remember, they increase lithium toxicity. All other diuretic, they increase lithium toxicity. Why? Because when we give these diuretic, high amount of sodium is delivered to collecting duct. All these diuretic, they increase ENaC channel on collecting duct. Because of high delivery of sodium in collecting duct, how the kidney will try to respond? The ENaC channel becomes more. If ENaC channel will become more lithium will be absorbed from this ENaC channel. So all these diuretic, they increase ENaC channel. Okay? So all these diuretic, they increase lithium toxicity except potassium sparing, and among potassium sparing, the drug of choice for lithium toxicity is amiloride. Okay? So remember these two points about amiloride. Amiloride can also be given for the treatment of hypomagnesemia, because only potassium sparing diuretic like amiloride, they can preserve magnesium. No other diuretic can preserve magnesium. Okay, they preserve magnesium. So they are given in hypomagnesemia. When the magnesium level in the body decreases, we can give amiloride as a diuretic. Okay, so remember this part. So these are the certain uses of potassium sparing diuretic. Now the last diuretic we have is osmotic diuretic. Okay, let's see what are the drugs we have. First we will write the names of the drug, then we will come to their mechanism of action. Among osmotic diuretic, we have IV drugs and we have oral drugs. Okay, the among IV drug, you will write the drugs are mannitol. Second you will write is urea. Among oral, you will write isosorbide and glycerol. Glycerol can be used or glycerine can be used, both are same. Okay. Now, what is their mechanism of action? Let's understand. These diuretic, when they are given into a blood vessel, when they come into a blood vessel, Remember, inside the blood vessel, there increase plasma osmolarity. They increase plasma osmolarity or plasma oncotic pressure. Okay, so they will increase plasma osmolarity. Can we say if there is increase in plasma osmolarity, the amount of water in the blood will decrease? The amount of water in the blood will decrease. Okay, now what will happen? These peripheral cells, what will happen? Let's say these peripheral cells of brain, eye, etc. The water will go from this intracellular compartment. The water will go move from this intracellular compartment into blood vessel. Now there is a condition in which the water in intracellular compartment increases. That condition is known as cerebral edema. Okay, and which occurs in brain and in eye, there is a condition known as narrow angle glaucoma. In narrow angle glaucoma, from the blood, the water is becoming leaking outside. In narrow angle glaucoma, the water is leaking outside. Why? This water is forming aqueous humor. So now, because of increase in plasma osmolarity, the water will not leak out. Hence, these two drugs are used in the treatment of cerebral edema and narrow angle glaucoma, because they will decrease the production of CSF and they will decrease the production of aqueous humor. In brain and eye respectively. Now what about kidney? Now sir, when they go to the nephron of the kidney, remember, these molecules, they are freely filtered in kidney. Okay, so they are freely filtered in the kidney. Now can we say inside the tubules, inside this PCT and descending tubule, they will increase osmolarity inside the tubules of nephron? As they are increasing the tubules osmolarity, what will happen? The blood and the intracellular compartments, they will try to remove the water into the urine. Okay, so from these cells, what will happen? The water will come into the blood and this water will go into the urine. And this water, along with various electrolytes, will be lost in urine. When water and electrolyte is lost in urine, they will produce diuretic action. Okay, so they increase the osmolarity in the renal tubule. Hence, the water will be drawn into the tubule from the blood and intracellular spaces. Okay, so they will produce diuretic action. So all the water and all the urine will be removed. Now let's see what are the uses of these drugs. We know the first use, we already know that these drugs, they will decrease the production of CSF, because CSF is produced from the filtration of water from the blood. And as we know that these drugs, they increase plasma oncotic pressure, the water will not be gone outside, the water will rather be, there will be opposite movement of water. So they will decrease the production of CSF. Hence, they are the drug of choice for cerebral edema. So they decrease the production of aqueous humor, because all these fluids, they are formed from filtration of blood. Okay, so they are the drug of choice for narrow angle glaucoma. Okay, Now let's see what are the other uses of these drugs we know. We will write. These drugs, they are used in impending renal failure. They are used in impending renal failure to increase GFR. To increase GFR means to increase the blood supply to the kidney so that more filtration of volume, what more water blood should go to the kidney and more filtration should occur. So in cases of impending renal failure, we get this point. But remember, they are absolutely contraindicated if kidney failure has already occurred. Okay? If kidney failure has already occurred, can we say that they will not be filtered? They will not be filtered from glomerulus. They will remain in the plasma and the plasma volume will expand. Okay? So only in some surviving nephron, when some nephrons are surviving, to increase the blood supply to the kidney, we give them in impending renal failure, but they are contraindicated if the kidney failure has totally occurred. Okay? If it is occurring, then we give. Okay? Now, last other uses of these drugs we will write. They're also given in, mannitol is given in cases of, you will write, mannitol is given in cases of certain poisoning of a drug. Why? To remove this drug into the urine. To remove these drug into the urine. Through their osmotic pressure. So let's see in which cases we give. Remember, mannitol is the drug of choice in cases of cisplatin toxicity or cisplatin poisoning. And in other drugs which where mannitol has been approved, you will write, it has also been approved for barbiturate toxicity. Also, bromide toxicity. Okay? You will write, it is also an approved drug to remove lithium into the urine and NSAIDs into the urine, out of the body. But what is expected from you? You just have to remember cisplatin. Cisplatin induced nephrotoxicity or cisplatin toxicity, to remove this drug into the urine, we give mannitol. Okay? We give mannitol. Through mannitol, this drug will be removed out into the urine. Okay? Remember this part. Now the last use of mannitol you will write is, mannitol is given during hemodialysis. Why? To maintain plasma osmolarity. To maintain plasma osmolarity. Why? Because during hemodialysis, sometimes the plasma will become suddenly hypoosmolar. Why plasma becomes certainly hypoosmolar? Because the solutes, they go out of the semi-permeable membrane. Okay, so that condition, that disease is known as, that disease is known as dialysis disequilibrium. That disease is known as dialysis disequilibrium. Drug of choice is mannitol. Okay, drug of choice is mannitol. So it is given during hemodialysis to maintain plasma osmolarity. Okay, so if plasma osmolarity is not maintained, that is known as disequilibrium due to dialysis. Okay, so remember this part. Now these are the uses of mannitol like drug. Now what are the contraindication? Remember, mannitol is absolutely contraindicated in CKD if kidney failure has occurred. Okay, but it was given in impending renal failure. Second point you will write, it is absolutely contraindicated in heart failure. Or you will write acute pulmonary edema. Heart failure leads to acute pulmonary edema. Now the point is, why? Can we say that these diuretics, they increase plasma volume, द प्लाज्मा वॉल्यूम विद दिस डायूरेटिक्स दे इंक्रीज दे एक्सपेंड प्लाज्मा वॉल्यूम. डोंट यू थिंक दिस प्लाज्मा इट गोज टू द हार्ट एंड दिस हार्ट हैज टू पंप दिस प्लाज्मा. इफ ऑलरेडी द हार्ट इज अंडरगॉन इन टू फेलियर वुड यू लाइक टू इंक्रीज प्लाज्मा वॉल्यूम बाई ऑस्मोटिक डायूरेटिक. द आंसर इज एब्सोल्यूटली नॉट. ओके सो इन केसेज ऑफ हार्ट फेलियर वी नेवर इंक्रीज द प्लाज्मा वॉल्यूम. सो द डायूरेटिक विच इज इट इज द ओनली डायूरेटिक विच इज कॉन्ट्राइंडिकेटेड इन हार्ट फेलियर इज मैनिटॉल और ऑस्मोटिक डायूरेटिक्स लाइक मैनिटॉल. दे आर द ओनली डायूरेटिक विच आर एब्सोल्यूटली कॉन्ट्राइंडिकेटेड इन हार्ट फेलियर. रेस्ट ऑल अदर डायूरेटिक्स वी कैन गिव इन हार्ट फेलियर. रेस्ट ऑल अदर डायूरेटिक वी गिव इन हार्ट फेलियर एक्सेप्ट मैनिटॉल. ओके लास्टली इट इज एब्सोल्यूटली कॉन्ट्राइंडिकेटेड इफ देर इज ऑलरेडी सम ब्लीडिंग इज अकरिंग. इफ ऑलरेडी सम ब्लीडिंग इज अकरिंग वी डोंट गिव दीज ड्रग. सो दे आर एब्सोल्यूटली कॉन्ट्राइंडिकेटेड इन हीमोरेजिक स्ट्रोक because they will come out of the capillaries. So they are absolutely contraindicated in hemorrhagic stroke. So these are now hello friends, let's discuss about ADH hormone, that is antidiuretic hormone, which is also known as vasopressin. Okay, so the first point is where this ADH hormone is synthesized. This ADH hormone is synthesized in hypothalamus. Okay? In the neurons of hypothalamus, which neurons of hypothalamus we will write, they are synthesized in supraoptic and paraventricular nucleus of hypothalamus. Paraventricular nucleus. So, in these hormones, ADH, in these neurons, in these neurons, this ADH hormone is synthesized. Okay. Now let's talk about the effect of vasopressin or ADH hormone in our body. Okay. Now remember, ADH hormone, it acts on receptors, and depending upon the type of receptor, it will produce effect. And these receptors are divided into three types: ADH receptor or vasopressin receptors. They are divided into three. They are known as V1. V2 and V3. So why they are known as V stand for vasopressin. Now remember one point, V1 is sometimes known as V1A and V13 is sometimes known as V1B. Okay, so these are the three receptors of vasopressin in our body. You will write that these all receptors are GPCR. They all are GPCR. GPCR stand for G protein coupled receptors. Okay, G protein coupled receptor. Now this V1 is GQ type, V3 is also GQ type. Okay, that means they increase the level of IP3 DAG, inositol triphosphate diacylglycerol, IP3 DAG. G2 is GS type, it increases cyclic AMP level. Okay, now when vasopressin act on these receptors, let's see what is the effect produced. Okay, so let's say where they are present and what is the effect produced. Location: V1, it is present on smooth muscles. It is present on smooth muscles. Let's say in the examples of blood vessels. And when it act on the smooth muscles of blood vessel, it produces vasoconstriction. It produces vasoconstriction. So the main action of vasopressin is vasoconstriction. That is why the word vasopressin has come. That is why the word vasopressin has come, because it is pressing the vessels, it is producing vasoconstriction. Okay, so it is present on, suppose this is a blood vessel, there are the endothelial cells. Below endothelial cells, you know, there are smooth muscles. So V1 receptor is present on smooth muscle and causes vasoconstriction. Let's talk about V2 receptor. V2 receptor is present in two locations. One you will write is endothelial cells, and second you will write is kidney. Okay, now V2 receptors, they are present on the surface of endothelial cells, like here. So on blood vessel, on these endothelial cells we have V2, on smooth muscles we have V1. Okay. Now, when vasopressin act on these receptor and stimulate these endothelial cells, they start to produce one certain clotting factors. When vasopressin act on endothelial cell produce von Willebrand factor and factor 8. So endothelial cells, they produce von Willebrand factor and factor 8 when vasopressin act on them. Okay, so it vasopressin stimulate these clotting factor production. So they are clotting factors. Remember. Now, what they will do, what vasopressin or ADH hormone will do to the kidney, it will act on medullary portion of collecting duct. Okay, suppose this is a nephron, this is the proximal convoluted tubule, descending limb of Henle, loop of Henle, ascending limb. Then we have distal convoluted tubule, then we have collecting duct. So this part is collecting duct. Now remember, kidney is divided into upper cortical portion and lower medullary portion. In this medullary portion, remember ADH hormone acts. When ADH hormone act on this medullary portion, it reabsorbs water back into the blood. It take out the water from the urine back into the blood. So what is the function of antidiuretic hormone in medullary portion of the kidney? It reabsorbs water. How it reabsorbs water? By increasing the formation of aquaporins. By increasing the formation of aquaporins, and these aquaporins increases permeability of collecting duct. If the permeability of collecting duct is increased, more water will be reabsorbed back into the blood. So what will happen to the urine volume? Can we say it will decrease urine volume? As it is decreasing the urine volume, that is why the word name has come, antidiuretic hormone, because it suppresses urine volume, because it reabsorbs water back into the blood. That is why the word antidiuretic has come. Now what about V3? V3 is non-significant for us. It is present in certain areas like pituitary, and when vasopressin act on pituitary, it stimulates the release of ACTH hormone, which is not an important concept right now for us. So what is important as a pharmacological point of view as a drug, we will be discussing more about V1 and V2. So V1 is present on blood vessel, produces vasoconstriction. V2 is present on endothelial cells and kidney. On endothelial cell, it increases the production of clotting factors. On kidney, it will act on medullary portion of collecting duct and reabsorb water back into the blood. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. Let's talk about certain drugs which will act as a vasopressin. So if we talk about now pharmacology, we have two kinds of drug which will act on this system. The first drug we will be having is vasopressin agonist, and second drug we will be having will be vasopressin antagonist. Okay, so vasopressin agonist, they will stimulate V1 or V2 receptors. These drugs, they will be ending with the word pressin. All these drugs, they will end with the word pressin. And all drugs which are vasopressin antagonist, they will block vasopressin receptor, they will end with the word Vaptan. Okay, so what they will be doing, vasopressin agonist will stimulate vasopressin receptor, and vasopressin antagonist, they will block vasopressin receptor. They will produce opposite response. So let's start with the first drug, that is vasopressin agonist. Okay, so vasopressin agonist, so let's make a heading. Okay, so the first class of drug we have is V1 plus V2 agonist. That means they will act on all receptors. They will act on all receptors. You'll write the first drug is human vasopressin. We have made human vasopressin as a drug. okay, human vasopressin. This human vasopressin is also known as arginine vasopressin. Arginine vasopressin. Now this drug is given as an IV drug. We will see their uses shortly. We have developed now second class of drug, that is swine vasopressin, which is obtained from pigs. Swine vasopressin. This swine vasopressin is also known as lysine vasopressin. It is also known as lysine vasopressin. Okay. Now it is also given IV and it is a longer acting. It is a longer acting. Now this lysine vasopressin is sometimes known as lipressin. Another name is lipressin. Okay. Lipressin. Okay, so these drugs you must remember, which is important for you. Now we have a class of drug which is selective V1 or V2 receptor agonist. That means there are certain drugs which will act selectively on V1 or selectively on V2. So let's see what are the drugs we have now, selective drugs. First, we will write selective V1A agonist. So we will be very specific. Then we have selective V2 agonist. Among selective V1 agonists, you will write the drugs are, two drugs are there. The first drug you will write is terlipressin. So it's a synthetic drug. And second drug you will write is felipressin. Among selective V2 agonists, you will write a drug, a very important drug for you, desmopressin. That is desmopressin. Now remember, desmopressin is also known as DDAVP. Another name of desmopressin is DDAVP. Full form is desamino D arginine vasopressin. Okay, so this is the full form of desmopressin. It's a selective V2 agonist. Okay, selective V2 agonist. Now let's see the uses of these drugs. Let's see the uses of these drugs. Let's talk about this felipressin, terlipressin. Felipressin right now is not approved. Okay, right now not approved. Now terlipressin, you will write, it is given IV, and this terlipressin is the drug of choice for bleeding esophageal varices. It is the drug of choice for bleeding esophageal varices. Now what happens, what do we mean by varices? Varices means dilated blood vessel. Varices means dilated blood vessels. They are so much dilated that they rupture and the patient has the symptoms of blood and vomiting. Okay, so dilated blood vessels. So why we are giving terlipressin? Terlipressin is acting on V1 agonist, and V1 agonist, we know it is present on blood vessel. It will produce vessel constriction. It will constrict these dilated blood vessels. Okay, so it is a drug of choice in bleeding esophageal varices. Now in bleeding esophageal varices, we use two drugs. Either we use terlipressin or we use octreotide. Okay, but the drug of choice is terlipressin. Why? Because it is the most effective drug we have. Octreotide is also a vasoconstrictor, but it is the most commonly used drug. Because in certain countries, terlipressin is not present. But if somebody will ask you the drug of choice, then the drug of choice is terlipressin. Okay? Now, second use of terlipressin is, it is also the drug of choice for norepinephrine resistant shock. Norepinephrine resistant shock. Why? Because terlipressin is a vasoconstrictor, it will go to the blood vessel and produce vasoconstriction, Because of this reason, terlipressin will increase blood pressure. Okay. Similarly, a similar condition, it is the drug of choice for hepatorenal syndrome. Because in the renal arteries, the blood supply reduces. It is a drug of choice for hepatorenal syndrome. Due to liver failure, the blood supply to the kidney decreases. To restore that blood supply, that blood pressure, we give terlipressin. Okay, and it is also sometimes given in cardiac arrest. Now, at all these uses, remember, in place of all these uses, you can also give IV arginine vasopressin. It also has same use. Or you can also give IV lipressin. So IV arginine vasopressin and IV lipressin also have same uses, but now the drug of choice has become terlipressin because of its selective action. We prefer to give terlipressin. Okay, if terlipressin is not given in the option, you can mark those non-specific drugs. They are also mainly used to produce V1 like effect. Okay, they were also used to produce V1. So this is about terlipressin. So instead of terlipressin, you can write arginine or lipressin. Now what about desmopressin? Desmopressin is acting on V2 receptor. So let's make about desmopressin. What are the uses? Now, unlike terlipressin, which was just given IV, desmopressin, you will write, it's a V2 agonist. And it can be given through many routes. What is the route of administration? You can give by injection IV. You can give orally also. And you can give intranasal also. Okay? But recently, these intranasal preparations, they got banned. I will tell you why they got banned shortly. Okay? So right now, it is given only by injection or sometimes oral route. Now it is acting on V2 receptor, and if you remember, I told you V2 receptor was present on endothelial cell and kidney. In endothelial cell, ADH hormone increases the synthesis of 1 Willebrand factor and factor 8. Remember factor 8 and 1 Willebrand factor? So the first use of desmopressin is a drug of choice for mild cases of 1 Willebrand factor deficiency and hemophilia A. What happens in hemophilia A? Factor 8 deficiency occurs. So if it is mild cases, the drug of choice is desmopressin. If it is severe deficiency, then give recombinant clotting factors. But if there is mild deficiency, the drug of choice is desmopressin. Because desmopressin can be given orally, and it is a very cheap drug also. Okay. Now, second use of desmopressin is in kidney. We know that in kidney, ADH hormone reabsorb water. It reabsorb water. So there is one condition in which there is, in the body, there is no ADH hormone. That condition is known as central diabetes insipidus. In central diabetes insipidus, what happens? There is no production of ADH. So that is why the patient has generally passage of water into the urine. Patient suffers from polyuria. Okay. So the drug of choice is desmopressin. It will reabsorb water from the kidney. Okay, but remember, the desmopressin is of no use in nephrogenic DI or nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Now, what happens in nephrogenic diabetes insipidus? In nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, remember, the V2 receptors on kidney are defective. They are not responding. Okay, So in this case, remember, desmopressin has no role because desmopressin will not able to act on V2 receptor. The V2 receptors are defective. In nephrogenic diabetes inhibitors, the drug of choice is thiazide diuretics. Okay, except lithium induced nephrogenic DI, nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. In lithium induced nephrogenic DI, diabetes insipidus, we don't prefer to give thiazide. Why? Because thiazides, they increase lithium toxicity. They increase toxicity of lithium. In lithium induced DI, remember, the drug of choice is one more diuretic known as amiloride. The drug of choice is amiloride. Remember. So among nephrogenic DI, the drug of choice is thiazides. And in lithium induced DI, the drug of choice is amiloride. Remember this part. Now the last use of desmopressin, you will write, desmopressin is also given in cases of, it is the drug of choice for nocturnal enuresis, which is also known as bedwetting. Okay, so you know that this bedwetting is very commonly seen in children. This bedwetting or nocturnal enuresis, they are a very common symptom in children. So in children, they generally, they pass out urine when they are asleep. So when a child needs a treatment of bedwetting, remember, a child needs a treatment of bedwetting when this child is more than 6 to 7 years of age. Then this child needs treatment. Remember, the first treatment of nocturnal enuresis in that child is not the drug. The first treatment is change the behavior. Change the lifestyle or the behavior of that child. Like, tell that child in the night to voluntarily wake up and go and pass out urine. We do alarm method. Okay. Decrease water intake before sleep. And pelvic floor muscle exercise. Tell that child to voluntarily hold the urine. That will increase the tone or strength of pelvic muscle floor. If it is still not controlled by these lifestyle, then we start a drug. Then the drug of choice is desmopressin. What is the route? Remember, oral. Oral route, okay? So syrups are available, tablets are also available. So it can be given orally. Now what is the mechanism of action? It will decrease water content of urine. Desmopressin will reabsorb water from the urine, so the bladder will not become empty, very full. But what are the other drugs which we can use? You can give imipramine. You can give oxybutynin. These drugs, they will relax detrusor muscle of the bladder. Hence the bladder will not contract. Okay, so these are the drugs which we give. So the drug of choice for nocturnal enuresis is desmopressin. Now let's see what are the side effects of desmopressin we know. Okay, so the side effect of desmopressin is, sir, can we say if this desmopressin will reabsorb water from the urine back into the blood, desmopressin causes increase in water content in the blood. Because of this reason, the blood will become dilutional. So water content will increase. And as compared to water, the sodium content of the blood will decrease. So it will lead to dilutional hyponatremia. Okay, it will lead to dilutional hyponatremia, which was seen very common with intranasal preparation. Intranasal preparation, they were causing sudden dilutional hyponatremia. If hyponatremia develops suddenly, it becomes very dangerous. So what are the symptoms of dilutional hyponatremia? We know when the patient suffers from dilutional hyponatremia, patient has nausea, vomiting, patient can have seizures. Because of these risk of seizures, we have banned the intranasal preparation of desmopressin. Okay, so remember this part. So main side effect of desmopressin is dilutional hyponatremia because it reabsorbs water from the kidney. Now let's talk about vasopressin antagonist. Now vasopressin antagonist, they will block vasopressin receptor and they will end with the word Veptan. They will end with the word Veptan. So let's see what are the drugs we have. The first drug one we have is V1A plus V2 antagonist. And the second drug we have is V2 antagonist. Okay. Now first let's see what are the drugs we have. Here the drug name you will write is Conveptan. It's an approved drug. And this Conveptan is given IV. Okay. Now what about V2 antagonists which are present on kidney V2 receptor? You will write Tolveptan. Mosaveptan and Lixiveptan. Okay, and these drugs you will write are oral drug, and among them try to remember the name of Tolveptan and Conveptan. This name you must remember. Okay, now as you are seeing that V2 receptor is coming in both, and V2 receptor we discussed was present on kidney, and when ADH hormone acts on kidney and the amount of ADH hormone is very high, and ADH hormone acts on kidney, can we say due to high amount of ADH, it will reabsorb all water, it will reabsorb water from V2 receptor of kidney. Okay, so high amount of ADH in the kidney reabsorb water from the kidney. So these drugs, they are used for the treatment of a condition known as dilutional hyponatremia. So these drugs, they are used for the treatment of dilutional hyponatremia, which occurs in cases of very high amount of ADH, because this ADH will reabsorb water from the kidney. So the blood content of water will increase and the sodium content will decrease. So blood will become dilute. So this is known as dilutional hyponatremia. Okay. Now this dilutional hyponatremia, the cause is SIADH. The cause of dilutional hyponatremia is SIADH. SIADH stands for syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. This high ADH is also seen in cases of heart failure, CHF. It is also seen in cases of cirrhosis of liver, and it is also seen in cases of polycystic kidney disease because of high production of ADH. Okay, so this dilutional. Now the point is, sir, if this hyponatremia is developing acutely, then we give Conveptan. Okay, so you will write, if there is acute SIADH or acute hyponatremia, we give Conveptan. If there is chronic SIADH or chronic hyponatremia, we give oral drug. Because Conveptan was IV, we give oral Tolveptan. We give oral Tolveptan. Now why we are giving? Because these drugs, they will block B2 receptors on kidney. Okay, and hence water will be excreted out in urine because ADH will not able to act on kidney because the receptors are blocked. Okay, so remember this part. Now the point is, sir, in this chronic SIADH, why we are giving tolvaptan? Because tolvaptan was blocking B2 receptor. It blocks B2 receptor. There is one more drug which can block V2 receptor, but it is not a Veptan class. That drug can be given like tolvaptan. That drug you will write is dimethylcycline. There is one more drug which you have to remember, dimethylcycline. Dimethylcycline also blocks V2 receptor. And like tolvaptan, it is also an oral drug. Now, what is this dimethylcycline? This dimethylcycline is an antibiotic. It's an antibiotic, but it has a property of tolvaptan. So it is not because of its antibiotic nature we are using in chronic SIADH, because it also blocks V2 receptor just like tolvaptan. So remember this word, dimethylcycline also block V2 receptor just like tolvaptan. So these two are the drug of choice for chronic SIADH, that is syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. Okay. Now certain other drugs which are new drugs, but right now they are not approved. New drugs, but right now not approved. Just write these drugs for your reference. It is very unlikely that examiner will ask you this question. So you will write the drugs specific V1A antagonist, specific V1B, which was also known as V3 antagonist. Okay, so just write their names just for your reference. You can afford to forget them also. Relcoveptan, Beloveptan. Here you will write Neliveptan. So these just for your reference, no need to remember them because right now they are not approved. Very soon they will get approved. Okay. So this is about vasopressin. Thank you very much. Hello friends, now let's make a summary of these diuretics. Okay, so we discussed mainly four classes of diuretic, that were carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. We discussed about loop diuretics, thiazides and potassium sparing. Okay, now let's talk about what will happen to the blood electrolyte level when we will be using these drugs. Now we will first discuss about carbonic anhydrase inhibitor like acetazolamide like drug. Acetazolamide like drug, they act at a level of PCT and they inhibit enzyme carbonic anhydrase, which will inhibit the reabsorption of sodium and bicarbonate into the urine. Okay, sodium and bicarbonate. So what will happen, this sodium and bicarbonate will be lost in urine. If they are lost in urine, can we say there will be decrease in blood sodium level? There will be decrease in blood sodium level, hence the level of blood sodium will decrease. And all these drugs you are seeing will decrease blood sodium level. That is why they are known as diuretics. That is why they are known as diuretics. Why? Because they are decreasing blood sodium level. So carbonic anhydrase inhibitor will inhibit reabsorption in PCT, proximal convoluted tubule. Loop diuretic will act in this medullary portion of the kidney. Okay. Thiazides, they are green in color. They will act in cortical portion. And
these potassium sparing diuretic, they will act in the collecting duct system in the cortical portion. Now, first point, what will happen to the potassium level? The first three diuretic, that is carbonic anhydrase, loop and thiazide, they cause hypokalemia, they decrease blood potassium level. Why the first three drugs, they are causing hypokalemia? Because when we inhibit this first, second and third, loop and thiazide and carbonic anhydrase, can we say there will be more sodium delivery to the collecting duct? If there is more sodium delivery to the collecting duct, they cause hypokalemia, first three, because there will be more sodium delivery to the collecting duct, and high sodium delivery will exchange, here the sodium will get reabsorbed in the collecting duct in exchange of potassium. In exchange of potassium, the sodium will be reabsorbed back. So what will happen? The potassium will be lost, but the amount of sodium which is reabsorbed is very less. Okay, so they cause hypokalemia. While the last potassium sparing diuretic, they cause hyperkalemia. They cause hyperkalemia because we are directly inhibiting reabsorption of sodium in the collecting duct portion. Now the point is, which of the following drug among first will cause maximum hypokalemia? Remember, maximum hypokalemia is caused by potassium acetazolamide, that is carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, they cause maximum hypokalemia. So maximum is caused by the first one, carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, they cause maximum hypokalemia like acetazolamide. Okay, then next maximum is thiazides, and least hypokalemia you will write is by loop. Okay, so the maximum hypokalemia is caused by carbonic anhydrase, then thiazide, then loop. Okay, now let's talk about the other ions. If you talk about this carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they will increase blood hydrogen level. The hydrogen level in the blood will increase. Why? Because they cause bicarbonate loss. So let's see these two points with carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. Can we say that carbonic anhydrase inhibitor inside the blood, they will decrease potassium level and they will decrease bicarbonate level? When the bicarbonate level will decrease, hence the equal amount of H plus ions will increase in the blood, because bicarbonate and H plus, they remain in equilibrium. So what they will cause in blood? Carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, they cause hypokalemic, that means less potassium, metabolic acidosis. Hypokalemic, metabolic acidosis, that means less potassium, more hydrogen. Why more hydrogen? Because of less bicarbonate. Now who will compensate for this bicarbonate in the blood? Remember, the chloride ions will compensate for this bicarbonate in the blood. But remember, chloride ion cannot affect acid-base balance. So there will be acidosis, but the level of chloride will be increased. So there will be hyperchloremic carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. They cause hyperchloremic, hypokalemic, metabolic acidosis. Okay, hyperchloremic, hypokalemic, metabolic acidosis is the classical side effect of these drugs, acetazolamide like drug. Okay, so remember this part. What about the other drug? Let's talk about loop. Remember, if you see the loop diuretic, you just write one point, loop loses all ions in the blood, while thiazide also loses all ion except calcium. Thiazide preserve calcium. Okay, so if you talk about these two points, about potassium and hydrogen with loop and thiazide, they both will cause hypokalemic metabolic alkalosis. Hypokalemic metabolic alkalosis. So the first drug were causing metabolic acidosis, लूप एंड थायजाइड दे बोथ कॉज हाइपोकैलेमिक मेटाबॉलिक एल्कलोसिस. ओके नाउ रिमेंबर द पॉइंट दैट थायजाइड्स दे प्रिजर्व कैल्शियम. लूप लूजेस ऑल, लूप लूजेस ऑल, थायजाइड ऑल्सो लूजेस एक्सेप्ट दे प्रिजर्व कैल्शियम. ओके नाउ व्हाट अबाउट पोटेशियम स्पेरिंग? पोटेशियम स्पेरिंग प्रिजर्व ऑल, दे लूज ओनली सोडियम. दैट इज वाई दे आर नोन एज दे लूज ओनली सोडियम एंड दे प्रिजर्व ऑल, दे प्रिजर्व ऑल. ओके सो रिमेंबर दिस पार्ट. सो इफ यू टॉक अबाउट वॉट विल हैपन विद देम, यू विल राइट दीज ड्रग्स. इफ यू टॉक अबाउट दीज टू पॉइंट पोटेशियम एंड हाइड्रोजन, दीज ड्रग्स दे कॉज पोटेशियम स्पेरिंग हाइपरकैलेमिक मेटाबॉलिक एसिडोसिस. दे कॉज हाइपरकैलेमिक मेटाबॉलिक एसिडोसिस. ओके सो फर्स्ट ड्रग एसिटाजोलामाइड लाइक ड्रग दे वर कॉजिंग हाइपोकैलेमिक मेटाबॉलिक एसिडोसिस. लूप एंड थायजाइड टुगेदर दे आर कॉजिंग हाइपोकैलेमिक मेटाबॉलिक एल्कलोसिस एंड पोटेशियम स्पेरिंग दे कॉज हाइपरकैलेमिक मेटाबॉलिक एसिडोसिस. नाउ द लास्ट पार्ट इज सर विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग ड्रग कॉजेस मैक्सिमम सोडियम लॉस? सर मैक्सिमम सोडियम लॉस इज बाय लूप. मैक्सिमम सोडियम लॉस इज बाय योर लूप. कैन वी से देन द मोस्ट इफेक्टिव डायूरेटिक विल बी लूप डायूरेटिक? ओके सो लेट्स टॉक अबाउट द मोस्ट इफेक्टिव डायूरेटिक. द मोस्ट इफेक्टिव डायूरेटिक इज लूप डायूरेटिक. दैट इज वाई लूप डायूरेटिक इज ऑल्सो नोन एज हाई सीलिंग डायूरेटिक. हाई सीलिंग वाई? बिकॉज इट्स इफेक्ट गोज वेरी हाई अप टू द सीलिंग. हाई सीलिंग डायूरेटिक. ओके वट अबाउट मीडियम सीलिंग? मीडियम इफेक्टिव. मीडियम यू विल राइट थायजाइड्स. थायजाइड दे आर नोन एज मीडियम सीलिंग डायूरेटिक. Okay, then we have after medium sealing we will write then we have mild efficacy. Mild efficacy, these are acetazolamide or carbonic anhydrase inhibitor or carbonic anhydrase. Okay, so they are sometimes known as weak, low ceiling diuretic. They are known as low ceiling diuretics. Okay, and the weakest diuretic we have, which will cause minimum sodium loss, will be potassium sparing diuretic. Potassium sparing diuretics. Okay, they are also known as low ceiling. So remember, high ceiling diuretic is loop, medium ceiling or medium efficacy are thiazide, and low ceiling or weak diuretic are acetazolamide, and among the weaker than acetazolamide is potassium sparing. So these are the diuretic on the basis of their sodium excreting potential. Okay, so this is the summary of diuretic which you must remember. Okay, this you must remember. Now if you are seeing, can you tell me two diuretics which are preserving calcium? By seeing this graph, can you tell me two diuretics which are preserving calcium? There are two diuretic which can preserve calcium, that is thiazides and potassium sparing. So you will write calcium is preserved by, that means calcium is not excreted by thiazides and very less by potassium sparing also. Can you tell me the only diuretic which can preserve magnesium? the only diuretic which can preserve magnesium. The only diuretic which can preserve magnesium is potassium sparing. Okay, so magnesium is preserved only by potassium sparing. Okay, so these are the two additional points you must remember. Calcium is preserved by both thiazide and mainly thiazide. So thiazides, they are the drug of choice if the calcium level in the body is low, because kidney is excreting high amount of calcium in the urine. If you want to preserve calcium, we give thiazide. If you want to preserve magnesium, we give potassium sparing diuretic. So this is the overall summary of diuretic which you must remember. Okay, thank you very much.
Hello friends, now today we will be discussing about a concept of free water clearance. Now what do we mean by the free water clearance? The definition of free water clearance is, it is the volume of plasma that is cleared or that is cleared solute free. Let's assume this solute as sodium per unit time. This is known as free water clearance. Now what do we mean by this term? Let's understand the concept of free water clearance. Okay, sir, suppose this is our blood, and this the plasma in our blood, it has certain osmolarity. Let's assume that the osmolarity of the plasma is 300 milliosmol per liter. That means the plasma has some amount of water and some amount of sodium. Okay, so this plasma has some amount of water and some amount of sodium. Now suppose this plasma goes to kidney. This plasma goes to the kidney. And we know that when it goes to the kidney, and this is a nephron of a kidney, this plasma goes into this nephron, and when it passes out of the nephron, it is known as urine. Now just imagine, when this urine is being passed out of the body through this kidney, let's assume the osmolarity of the urine is also 300 milliosmol per liter. That means it has equal amount of sodium and equal amount of water as compared to plasma. Can we say that if kidney, when it is not functioning, if there is total kidney failure, this amount of plasma will simply come out of the body, and this plasma which will form urine which will also be having same osmolarity that of plasma. So when this kidney is not functioning, can we say the osmolarity of the plasma and osmolarity of the urine should be same, because that same plasma will simply come out of the body. Okay, let's call that this range, when the osmolarity of the urine is same like that of plasma, can we say equal amount of water and sodium which was present in the plasma, that equal amount of sodium and water will come out into the urine. Okay, let's call this term as zero water clearance. Zero water clearance means the amount of sodium and water in the urine is same that of plasma. It is isosmotic that of plasma. Now the point is, when your kidney is perfectly functioning, then most of the time the osmolarity of the urine is not similar to that of plasma. When it is not similar to that of plasma, let's assume Suppose when you drink lot of water, what happens? When you drink lot of water, can we say extra amount of this water pass out into the urine? So sometimes in our urine, what we see, the amount of water is more as that of sodium. Okay, can we call this urine as a very dilute urine? So generally, normally, when we pass out dilute urine, we pass out dilute urine when we drink lot of water. That is known as polydipsia. Okay, or when there is an hormone known as ADH function, this ADH normally it removes water back into the blood. If this ADH hormone is not functioning, can we say this water will come out into the urine? So dilute urine is also found when there is no ADH in the body. That is known as diabetes insipidus, because the function of ADH hormone is to reabsorb water back into the blood. So these are the two causes of dilute urine. And can we say in dilute urine, when we drink lot of water and in absence of ADH, the urine is very dilute, water is getting removed more as compared to sodium. This condition is known as, can we say water is getting more removed? Let's call this situation as positive, because water is getting more removed. Positive free water clearance. Positive free water clearance. So what happens in positive free water clearance? In positive free water clearance, the volume of this urine, it has excess of water as compared to sodium. Okay, this is known as positive free water clearance. Now there are certain scenarios when our kidney passes out a very concentrated urine. That means the amount of water in the urine is very less. The amount of water is very less and the amount of sodium is very high. Okay, so can we say in this case the amount of sodium is less? Let's call this condition as negative free water clearance. That means water is less. That is why we have written the word negative. Okay, negative free water clearance. Can we say in negative free water clearance, the urine becomes very concentrated? Concentrated urine or hyperosmolar urine. Now when we see this negative or free water clearance, when our body will try to preserve this water, when we don't drink ample amount of water, it will occur in cases of dehydration, when you are not drinking ample amount of water. So it occurs opposite when we are dehydrating. And secondly, when in the body the amount of ADH is very high, when the amount of ADH in the body is very high, that condition is known as SIADH. SIADH stands for syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. So this ADH will reabsorb water from the urine back into the blood. So what are the causes of increase in positive free water clearance? We will recapitulate. Positive free water clearance means water is coming out into the urine more than sodium. It occurs when you drink a lot of water and when ADH hormone is not working, because ADH hormone generally remove this water from the urine back into the blood. And negative free water clearance means when the water is getting less removed as compared to sodium in the urine. It occurs when you are not drinking ample amount of water and when ADH is working very high. Okay, now we have certain drugs which can alter this free water clearance. Okay, now let's talk about two kinds of drug we have. The first kind of drug we have is thiazides, and second class of drug we have is loop. They both are diuretics. Diuretic means they will remove sodium and water. Now let's see who will remove what. Suppose this is a nephron. And we know that the first part of nephron is PCT. In PCT, all the solutes get reabsorbed. Then we have descending limb of Henle. In descending limb of Henle, only water is reabsorbed. Then we have loop of Henle. Then we have ascending limb. This ascending limb becomes thick. Okay, this is known as thick ascending limb. It moves upwards. And then we have distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct. Okay, now remember, The deeper portion of the kidney are known as medulla, and upper portion of kidney is known as cortex. Okay. Now remember, in this medullary portion, only water is reabsorbed back into the blood. Okay. And this thick ascending lumen, here sodium can be reabsorbed back into the blood with the help of sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter. While in the cortical portion, so this was about the medullary portion. In medullary portion, remember, both sodium and water can be reabsorbed. In medullary portion, sodium and water both can be reabsorbed. Okay. Now what happens in cortical portion? Remember, in cortical portion of the kidney, only and only sodium is reabsorbed. Only and only sodium is reabsorbed. Okay. Now, these loop diuretic, remember, they act at medullary portion of kidney. They act at medullary portion of kidney. They inhibit sodium absorption and they reduce water absorption. Okay. So loop diuretic, they reduce both sodium and water reabsorption back into the blood. Because of this reason, both sodium and water is removed into the urine. Now what about thiazide? Thiazide, they will act on cortical portion. Thiazide, they only remove sodium in urine. That means they only prevent sodium reabsorption, while loop diuretic, they remove both sodium and water in urine. Okay, they remove both sodium and water in urine. So let's understand this point first, that thiazide, they only remove sodium. Loop diuretic, they mainly remove sodium plus water because they act in medullary portion, while thiazide, they act in cortical portion. They mainly remove sodium in urine. Now let's see what will happen to the water clearance. Okay, now can we say that sodium, when we give thiazides mainly remove sodium into the urine, very less water. Thiazides, they mainly remove sodium into the urine, very less water. Can we say it will create an opposite situation of positive free water clearance? In positive free water clearance, more of water is removed, less of sodium is removed. So when we give thiazide diuretic in presence of diabetes insipidus, when we give thiazide diuretic in presence of diabetes insipidus, they will create an opposite situation. They decrease positive free water clearance. Thiazide diuretic, they decrease positive free water clearance. Why? Because they will create an opposite scenario. Thiazides, they mainly remove sodium. They preserve water in a kind. So when you are giving thiazides in diabetes insipidus, they decrease positive free water clearance. Okay, more of sodium is removed, water is preserved. That is why thiazides are the drug of choice for DI, diabetes insipidus, because they will preserve water. Okay, so thiazide diuretic, remember, they reduce positive free water clearance, and you will write only in presence of diabetes insipidus. Now what about loop diuretic? Loop diuretic, sir, we know they remove both sodium as well as water. As they are removing sodium into the urine, they decrease positive free water clearance. And as they are removing water into the urine, as they are removing sodium into the urine, can we say in SIADH very high amount of sodium was getting removed into the urine? What happens in cases of SIADH and DI? Thiazides, they remove only sodium into the urine, while loop will remove sodium into the urine as well as water into the urine, both, because they act at medullary portion. Loop diuretic, they remove both sodium and water. Can we say that in presence of diabetes insipidus, they will decrease positive free water clearance? Loop diuretic, in this case, they will reduce positive free water clearance. While in cases of SIADH or dehydration, they will remove water also. Okay, so create an opposite scenario. They will reduce negative free water clearance as well. they will remove negative free or decrease negative free water clearance as well. So loop diuretic, they reduce positive free water clearance, that means they remove water. They also remove sodium, hence they will decrease the negative free water clearance and bring everything back to the normal. Bring everything back to the normal if anything was occurring in excess. Okay, so loop diuretics. So loop diuretic, they reduce both positive and negative free water clearance. So we will write this point that thiazide diuretic, they only reduce positive free water clearance. Why? They only reduce positive free water clearance because they remove mainly sodium. So excess of water is not removed. If excess of water was not removed, hence in cases of positive free water clearance, when excess of water was getting removed, they will decrease this positive free water clearance. What about loop? Loop will reduce both. Loop diuretics, they reduce both positive as well as negative free water clearance. They will reduce both positive as well as negative free water clearance. That means they cause sodium loss as well as water loss. So everything will become back to the normal. Everything will become isoosmotic. The urine will become isoosmotic after some time. Okay. So just remember, thiazide only positive, loop both positive as well as negative free water clearance. Okay. Chaliye. Thank you very much.